Welcome back to Husky Stadium. We're about ready to get underway with what I'm going to call the Battle of the Graybeards. There's only two Division I football coaches that have more tenure than the two coaches we're going to look at today. Lavelle Edwards, well, for over a quarter of a century, he's been at the controls of the BYU Cougars team. Now, on the other side of the ball, though, is Jim Lambright. He came here and played on the Huskies team and seemingly never left, but this is only his fourth year as a head coach. Now, for Lambright, he has one thing in his hip pocket. This team, the Huskies, are 10-0 in home openers.
Well, Jack, BYU won the flip, and they have deferred, and Washington will take the ball and go on the attack here with the first series of the game. Josar Zinka goes back deep now with their talented freshman Corey Dillon. And here's a young man kicking off who was a soccer player here at the university. In fact, his sister today is on a road trip over Portland with the women's team here at Washington. This is Ethan Hutchman kicking off for the Cougars. So his family here in the stands, you can just imagine how nervous this young man is right now. And we're underway in Seattle with a booming kickoff. This is Dillon going to bring it on out. And he is tripped up. Ball down on the carpet, but it may be down. They'll now sort it out. It will be Washington's ball, but far short of the 20-yard line as the Cougars with splendid coverage on that. That was Derek Stevenson, their very talented freshman, coming down to make that hit. So Washington quarterback Shane Fortney is better than he played against Arizona State. He is very tough on the rollout, good runner. The Chili's backs and receivers. Rashawn Sheehy is glad to be out of the desert. And the coaches believe that he's just now getting into shape. So we'll watch number one. He is set behind Fortney right now on the first play of the game from scrimmage. Fortney, incomplete, second and 10. Excellent coverage. But did you notice the kind of time that Fortney had behind the offensive line? And this offensive line is unsettled with the loss of a starting tackle. So Lynn Johnson moves into that spot. You know, the center spot has always been talented. Olin Krutz is right there. Defensively, BYU bends, but they try not to break. Shea Muirbrook is a heady leader at the middle linebacker spot. Then in the secondary, JC transfer Omar Morgan is known simply as the blanket. And he'll show us why all day long. Second down and 10. Sheehy moves up on the left wing. Everybody out. There's the first completion. And it winds up in the hands of Jerome Pathon with Tim McTyre knocking him out of bounds on that far sideline, short of the first down.
The reason he went right up the line of scrimmage and audible, they were in a three receiver, one side formation. BYU moved the entire defense over there, left the one-on-one situation up on top, and their game plan is to have a run called tied in with a pass quick, a pass check, and that's exactly what they did that time. They just audible to the quick pass.
Third and two, the toss to Sheehy looking for the first down. Eddie Keel making the stop, but it was enough for a first down for the Huskies.
There's going to be a real battle going on between big Cameron Cleland, number 85, the fine blocking tight end from the Huskies, against Spencer Reed, the strong side linebacker. Both coaches are really excited about seeing this matchup because they think they're both very talented players. So it's going to be a battle.
First and 10, the ball on the 28-yard line. Fortney snaps off to Sheehy, who was over there on the left side. There's a first down on the far sideline. Thirteen-yard gain.
See, they went empty, meaning they didn't have a back left in the backfield once they went in motion. Here's Sheehy comes out there, and the receiver just comes off and blocks inside, puts up the running back, Sheehy, in a one-on-one situation for a running back to make the tackle. See? For the defensive back, brother.
Ball out on the Huskies' 41-yard line. Sheehy, who can throw it, looked like he might be thinking option the way he was handling that football. That play definitely in the game plan for this contest.
And he definitely was thinking about trying to throw the football. but there was a good containment by Spencer Reed, the outside linebacker, right side of your screen. See, he's working inside out in the play. Sheehy wants to see, starting to take it out. And here come the blue and white people after him, and he couldn't throw it. Plus, it was covered downfield.
That's a 5-yard loss.
And you aren't going to fool Omar Morgan, the left corner from BYU, very often. We saw him in the Texas A&M game, and he played extremely well.
That's the first negative yardage play. Make it second and 15. That's Sheehy again shifting out over to the right hand side.
They like to throw the ball to tight end in this formation.
And they did exactly that to Cameron Cleland.
See, by putting that back out of the backfield, you stretch the corner away. Now, Cleland, number 85, comes off inside. The corner has been moved outside because of the movement of the running back out there, and it creates a little zone. Turn the right side of your screen now, you'll see a hole in the right top corner there created by widening the defense with that running back out as a flanker. Good game planning by Scott Linehan, the offensive coordinator. Now, they'd like to run the ball more, Brent. They would like to today to try to control the clock.
Well, here's a situation where they've got a choice, coach, because it is third and three.
They did not do a good job of this last week. They were 3 for 15.
Sheehy cuts up, has it to the 42-yard line.
See, they were in that three receiver set formation. They ran up behind it, and Sheehy now is running like he did last year. Last week, having missed most of training camp with a hamstring problem, he wasn't sharp. He didn't look like the Rashan Sheehy of a year ago. Fine running back, second string all Big Ten, Pac-10 last year, running more like he can run right now.
Cam Kissel, the H-back, number 11, with a strong block that freed him at the line of scrimmage. So the Huskies march to another first down. They have 58 yards on this particular drive. And there is Kissel, number 11, leading the way for Sheehy. But this time, not to be, as big Henry Bloomfield, the 300-pound senior, came across and made the play defensively for the Cougars.
Well, Ken Schmidt, the defensive coordinator for BYU, said he was going to slant his defensive linemen in directions favoring the tendencies of the Washington offense. And I think that's what they did that time. Washington has a tendency to go toward the man in motion, and they slammed the defensive lineman toward him.
2-yard loss on that play by Bloomfield. Make it now second down and 12 for the Huskies. They're at the Cougar 45-yard line. Slot man over there to the left for 40. He keeps it. Good runner. 35 inside the 30-yard line. And finally, Chris Ellison able to wrestle him to the artificial turf.
That's the advantage of having a sprinter as a quarterback. This guy was a 400-meter champion. And you'll see they pass set here. Get everybody out there. Then it's a design draw right up inside. Nice block by 77. Kreutz, he gets up there now showing his running ability. And he's a big guy, too, at 225 pounds. You better hit him square.
20-yard run by Shane Fortney. Makes it first and 10. And the Huskies move to the Cougars' 25-yard line.
Again, taking it back out of the backfield.
Fortney to throw on first down. In the face of pressure, he's able to hit his fullback slipping out of the backfield. Mike Reed.
Nice game planning by Scott Linehan and Bill Diedrich, Al Roberts, and Steve Morton. See, they're using backs out of the backfield. They haven't done that a lot in the past. It's something new. Defensively, you're going to have to adjust to it. Probably will have to roll the corner up into that man in motion and bring the safeties over. Too much of a cushion for a good running back.
9-yard gain on that completion by Reed. So it'll be second and one. They're just outside the Cougar 15-yard line. Huskies driving. Tight end to the right side, and there was movement over on the left-hand side, and that could be a critical error. So this will be against the Huskies, and they'll move it back 5 yards.
Dead ball. Ball start on the offense.
It's the 11th play of this drive. Ooh, Sheehy, big hole to the 9.
I'll tell you, there was an outstanding block by Benji Olsen, the offensive right guard that time. He came off the ball, and he just nailed him. Now, you'll see the block there, the left side of your screen. You see number 91 going backwards. That's Henry Bloomfield. He got his pads up too high. He must keep his pads down low, or a guy like Benji Olsen is going to buy him a ticket to the ball game.
They'll make it now first and 10. So this is first and goal for the Huskies right now. Almost a 5-minute drive to start the game for the Huskies. Sheehy picking his way to the 4-yard line against the Cougars.
Well, Ken Schmidt, the defensive coordinator for BYU, was very worried about the power and strength of this offensive line, and you can see why he's worried. His defensive line is not nearly as big as the people they're competing against. They're going to have to do some stunning and some blitzing, I think, to break the rhythm of this offense.
Well, the Huskies have decided to saddle it up and go right at him, and with a quarterback who can run, that puts enormous pressure on. This is the 13th play of this drive, 5 minutes in, second and goal. Fortney gives to Sheehy. This should be it. Touchdown, Huskies. Impressive 5-minute drive, Coach.
Very impressive, and doing what they wanted to do. They want to eat up the clock so BYU is on defense, not on offense. The Husky defense is not as experienced as the offense, and they want sort of blend that philosophy through the year until the Husky defense matures.
Well, John Wales still handling the extra points. Certainly short field goals makes it 7-0. The Huskies strike first.
This three receiver wingback set is giving BYU problems. It's creating a soft corner here and allowing him to get outside for the score. They had problems throughout the drive with that same formation. There was also a real fine block by Cameron Cleland, the big tight end. It went in and sealed off the linebacker. Here he is, number 85. Now he seals off Shea Mirbrook, 46, and prevents him from getting inside out on that play. And you put a good running back on a defensive back, the running back should win the battle, and Sheehy did.
So the Huskies lead it. 93-yard drive, 5:07, and new kickoff man today for Washington. Number 48 is Randy Jones, the freshman, 6'2", 210. Huskies think he's a kicker with a future here. James Dye and another speedster, Ronnie Jenkins, back now for the Cougars, who will handle for the first time today. Jenkins is on your right.
Nice kick.
At the 6-yard line, and Dye out to the 29-yard line, where BYU quarterback Steve Sarkisian, he's off to a quarterback of the year start. He sparked that earlier upset of Texas A&M. Now the BYU Chili's backs and receivers, and this lineup includes two very talented tight ends we'll see today. Now the Cougars will attempt to run, but they live by the pass, as you know, and this offensive line is huge and talented. Those two tackles look like well-conditioned basketball players, and here come the Cougars now with their first play. Killalui in motion, Sarkisian, fake Johnson, gonna go deep with the first pass, incomplete, and he overthrew KO. Well, defensively, Washington plays with reckless abandon, as you probably know, but the Huskies need this man, Ink Aliaga, to increase his production right there on the inside. The secondary features the game within the game, because two freshman cornerbacks go up against this BYU passing machine.
This is going to be a battle all day. Yancey on Bateman. Here they go. And Big Richie coming up inside. You know, he has that good inside move and gave him a problem on it.
Second and 10. Watch how much jumping and stunting and moving the Huskies do. Sarkisian gets time. Steps to the left. Receivers are covered. He's going to have to hoof it. And he does to the 39, where he's whacked by Jermaine Smith. And now that's a Coach Chow getting right after him.
Well, they threw the flag. They're going to call him 15 for hitting him out of bounds.
That's one of the freshmen right there, redshirt freshman, 5'11", 195, and that's an additional 15 then.
Yeah. Boy, that's really close, because he was coming inside out, flying as fast as he could come. It's number one, Jermaine Smith. See him working inside out. I'll tell you, that's close. That is really close. That's questionable.
Good ball.
Now Aliaga, number 54, linebacker. See, he gets a little, they're playing a little tight man on him inside there on Lewis, the tight end. And then he just swheels around there, see, and he's trying to get open. Couldn't get open, but it kept Aliaga tied up playing pass defense.
So a 9-yard run by Sarkisian. Then tack on 15 more yards because of the penalty. 24 yarder takes it down into Washington territory.
You know, and he can run better than given credit for. Last week on 3rd and 24, I saw on a game tape, he ran 25 yards for a first down.
The sun breaking out here in Seattle. Roll to the left, Sarkisian on the move, incomplete, and one of his tight ends right there was open, Chad Lewis.
See, that's one of the problems of throwing the ball on the move. You tend to overlead people when you're moving. You have to remember that your body is moving with the receiver, so you don't lead him as much.
Second and 10.
I don't know if you want to get BYU in an obvious passing down very often. They're so effective.
Kelahui in motion. At the top of your screen, settles in. Tackles hold up. But Sarkisian having trouble finding an open receiver on the move again. Great comeback block. Throws incomplete at the 22-yard line. Die the intended receiver.
See, they did have very good protection, but they had very good pass defense downfield. He could not find anybody to throw. Now, you'll see these big tackles on each side, pass setting real well. Nice pocket to step up inside to, but good intense pressure. They keep trying to get after him. Now they gradually flush him. Here comes Chorik, number 46, gets knocked down. But a lot of time to throw.
Matt Cox, the right guard, dropped back. But right now, Sarkisian and BYU a little bit concerned about this statistic. He's 0-for-3, and this is a young man who hits about 70-75% of football game. Right across the line, and we'll see if Richie was pulled. It appeared that he might have just broken across and was offside.
Yeah, he knows he's wrong.
Dead ball. Offside on the defense. 5 yards.
That's 20 yards in penalties. 97, middle of your screen, Richie. He's listening to the quarterback's command rather than watching the ball. And look at him. He says, I know I should not have done that.
You know,
fine
Cox
player.
Did not flinch. He was sitting down there at that right guard spot. Richie came, and he did not move down there. Another 5 yards tacked on. The ball is inside the 45-yard line now.
That's not a legal formation. They should call it.
Sarkisian again. Now this time he'll use the running back coming out of the backfield.
The offensive tackle was lined up in the backfield. He was back off the ball. You're not supposed to allow that. But they got away with it. No flag. Good check down there.
Atuhaya slipping out of the backfield is wrapped up by Burton. That's a 9-yard gain in the first completion for Sarkisian, and they move to another first down. Scoreboard operator better stay real alert here today with this one.
Here he comes out of the backfield. His parents flew all the way in from Hawaii to be here to see him play, and he just demonstrated some little ability there.
They come back with him as a running back, and they had made a change. That's young Brian McKenzie, the JC transfer who had replaced Mark after that completion. So McKenzie with his first carry, and Fiala making the stop.
Michigan up 3-0. It's going to get in. We have both the number one and number two rusher in junior college football from last year on the field today. Brian McKenzie, who was number two, and playing for Washington, who was number one, was Corey Dillon. Good recruiting by both schools.
Second and 7. Sarkisian blitz is picked up. Drops it off to McKenzie. McKenzie slips a tackle, steps inside that first down marker, we believe.
See, they blitzed and dropped the tackle. That was David Ritchie coming out. That was a zone blitz. David Ritchie came out of the defensive line position and got inside out on the play. Here's David Ritchie playing defensive left tackle right there. And they're going to blitz. They're going to bring people. And he'll drop. He gets in there. Now he'll come off it right now. See him holding on the line of scrimmage going down the 30-yard line. Good heads-up move by a defensive lineman.
McKenzie starting to look sharp, isn't he? Now the Cougars have advanced to the Huskies 22-yard line. McKenzie Nothing doing this time.
Real nice defensive play down there this time by Inkaliaga. He didn't make the tackle. He just knocked everybody back and ruined everything else within the play. Good job by Inkaliaga. You know, BYU likes to throw crossing patterns down here, get you a man, and they also like to pick you, meaning rub a defender off on another defender or offensive player. Not legal, but they get by with it.
Second and 10 for BYU. Being pursued and coming in and taking him is Jason Chorick.
Jason Chorick is their best pass rusher. He's also one of those guys that empties his bucket on every snap, meaning he just gives you everything he has to give on every single snap. He's always a lot of fun to watch play. He's on the left-hand side of your screen coming outside. Now here he comes down the backside, number 46. He should have been picked up from the backside. He didn't get, the offensive player didn't get there. Chorick is not the biggest defensive lineman at 250 pounds, but he is quick.
6 yard loss on that sack.
Love to coach those kind of football players, Brent. They just, they practice the way they play and they just love the game.
From the shotgun and the whistle before the snap. Wonder if the clock ran out this time.
Yeah, I saw Sarkisian signaling over to the bench. Get, see him signaling? Get the play in quicker, he's saying.
Dead ball. Delay the game on the offense. 5 yards.
If it hadn't been a delay of the game, there probably would have been holding and tackling by Tate, left tackle. See, he grabs a hold of him right. He's got him tackled. Good job. He must have been a high school wrestler. No, he wasn't. He competed in the track team.
Third and 22, and the Cougars have been backed up.
Coming after him with five people. They stun it inside and didn't pick it up.
On the run here in the first quarter, Sarkisian of BYU not being afforded the time he had against Texas A&M. So a big difference with this Husky defense and the pressure they are applying on Sarkisian here today.
They had a stun inside here and they didn't pick it up, so Richie got in there clean. See, it comes around. Here comes a stunt around there. That's Chris Campbell, number 35. Come, and that flushes him. The offensive linemen have to pass those defensive rushers off to each other. They shouldn't have let that guy in there clean.
So field goal time. Here's Pochman.
45-yarder. He hasn't attempted one from that distance just here.
The leg is long enough. If this is accurate, he can nail this.
No, it didn't hit it very good.
No good. Washington still leads. Coach Lambright has to be ecstatic with how his defense played on that series. You could 7-0. So in the first quarter, 89 yards offense for the Huskies and only 28 for the Cougars. Second series now for Washington, up a touchdown. Shane Fortney hands off now to Sheehy, and again finding room on the right side.
Good defensive play by the inside linebacker that ended up not making the tackle, Brent, but he pushed that play all the way outside so Samson, 36, the free safety, could come up and make the play. Defense is so important to be disciplined and carry out responsibility and pass things on off to your teammate. You can't make every play yourself.
But it was good for 5 yards. Sheehy now, and the Huskies face a second and 5. Offense loves to come up there with a second and 5, don't they? Off a fake, Fortney right over the middle, complete to midfield in the first down. Dave Janoski is the receiver.
What they did is they used a flanker in motion and shortened the formation with him coming in motion, and then used play action, and by bringing him in motion from the opposite side of the field, he could get over to where they wanted to throw the ball. Good design, very simple type action. Sometimes not the easiest ball to throw.
17 more yards for Fortney and the Huskies. Very accurate today.
He looks like a different kid than Fortney does today, in contrast to last week.
movement down there on the line. And here comes the penalty flag.
Nice job by Darren Tennessee, defensive right tackle that time. Boy, he did a nice job of ruining that play.
Jack Harut, Rashawn Sheehy is off to a good start here today.
And Brett, they needed a good start from him. He was a little shaky, and as you said, he's playing himself back into shape. Last year, he spelled Leon Neal quite a bit and made a name for himself, but he was lucky that he went home in the summer. Because here's what happened when he went home. His dad, Robert, assembled a bunch of coaches from Pop Warner High School in the area, sat down and looked at game tapes, and they were kicked back, figuring they were going to say what a great job Rashawn did. They said, hey, you're not playing the way you should. Came back with a new commitment here to Husky Land, and he's been doing very well ever since.
And Jack, 8 carries so far today for 31 yards. That's almost 4 yards a crack, and of course the one touchdown. Fortney back to throw, incomplete, misfired. Sheehy, the intended receiver.
He threw it out of bounds on purpose. Excellent, excellent coverage by Omar Morgan. Also excellent coverage on the tight end. They bracketed the tight end inside and outside with two linebackers, and they couldn't throw the ball to Cameron Cleveland that time, so he wisely just threw the ball out of bounds. He looked so much more poised. That is Shane Fortney. He looked so much more poised today than he did last week. He needed that one game under his belt.
Second down and 5. 4.5 minutes remain. The Huskies with the game's only score. A touchdown by Sheehy. And their first drive of the game. And Sheehy on a bit of a delay. Left side. First down. 35. 30. Inside the 20. Breaks free. Touchdown. 2 scores already for Rashawn Sheehy.
That formation spread the defense out, took Brad Martin, the outside linebacker on that side of the field, and spread him way out. And he had to come flying from his outside alignment position and to try to constrict the play. And Benji Olsen, the big offensive right guard, got a block on him just enough to bounce him outside, and off he went. Rashawn Sheehy running like he ran last year, the reason he was second team all Pac-10.
John Wells makes it a 14-point Washington lead as Sheehy 45 yards for their second score. Team nothing. And Sheehy with both scores, coach.
Here's the key right here. Big guard over here. Now he gets a nice hook block right there. See, nails Martin number 10, then Janoski number 19 gets a knock down there as a wide receiver. Now it's just running ability by Rashawn Sheehy.
Matt Cox is the right guard, number 76, who made that block, and that's about the third big block for Big Cox. Jones will kick it off again here for the Huskies, who look real sharp in the early going. 2 possessions, 2 touchdowns. BYU, 1 possession, a missed field goal. And now the Cougars will try it again. There's the man they would like to have handle the ball. James Dye. He's electric and dangerous. His option coming out for the 1. It's a beautiful kickoff. 15 looks for the alley. Penalty flag is down, and Dye slams to the carpet at the 25. Against the Cougars. Dick, let's talk about this passing game, because is it the fault of the offensive line not giving Sarkisian enough trouble, or are the wide receivers unable to break free?
Brent, so far I feel that the protection is good. What's happening is they're taking the routes away downfield with the coverage. They're playing a tight man.
Illegal block in the back on the return team. We have the distance from the goal. First down.
They're not really showing a great deal of respect for the speed of the receiver corps from BYU, so they're crowding him. He goes to throw it in rhythm, and there's no one to throw to.
Now there is the infraction right there, and it means that the Cougars will have to start back on their own 9-yard line, 91 yards away, tough field position. And the Huskies start jamming those gaps right away defensively, ready to come with 7-8 players at a crack. And the Cougars will run out of open market. A 2-eye getting the call.
Aliaga is always active. That time he's not in the middle. He's over on the left side of the defense as an outside linebacker at the top of your screen, number 54. And he'll find a way to get to the football. He'll move back inside and get up there and try to find a way to get there. I like him better when he's lined up over the ball because then he can go left and right.
Strong run on first down. Leaves the Cougars with 2nd and 5. And they'll show split back a passing formation.
See their crowd. Look at that coverage, Brent. Tight man to man. Bump and run on.
They're not going to. They're going to use McKenzie, and he slips down.
See, that's not a bad offensive call because you get that tight man to man, you can run all the pass defenders off, and you only need the key corner block by usually normally in that play your fullback. But that time the turf made the tackle. Here comes a crack block by Kealalui. Wham! Ooh, that smarts a little bit. He got that key block, but there was still one man left, Jermaine Smith.
Nigel Burton starting today at the Rover felt the sting of that.
Yes,
now it is 3rd down and 6 for Sarkisian and the Cougars, who trail it by 2 touchdowns. 7 men across that line. 5 rush wanted to flare, covered. Time in the middle, comes back incomplete. McKenzie claiming that he was held.
Kaoli. Kealalui, number 3, was wide open in the middle, and he was all upset on that time. They did a good job of picking up the stunt, and you'll see here, he'll end up down in the hole, and he gets all upset because they can't find him. They picked up the stunt nicely there. They handled the protection. He comes out of it. Here he comes right in the middle. Look at that, right in the middle. Look at, he's all upset. That's all right. Can't see everybody.
So Jerome Pathon will handle this punt. Alan Boardman punting, somewhat unusual because Janoski returned the punt for a touchdown.
It's a low return type punt.
Here's Pathon back at the 45, midfield to the 44-yard line. Well, Jackaroot, we do expect to see the young quarterback, even though Fortney has been impressive today.
Well, that's according to the game plan, Brent. We watched him as Brock Heward warmed up, and it's kind of interesting. Over here, there's a set of chairs where the offense sits down and gets their instructions. The one man that sat down was Shane Fortney. The man that did not sit down was Brock Heward. Heward had a ball. He was back passing back and forth, and he has now gone into the game. Fortney having a good game, but he finds himself on the sidelines.
Well, the 3rd series, this is what the coaches planned, and Brock Heward steps in now. He's a left-handed quarterback. Very easy throwing motion. And Dillon checks into that backfield, has a swing pass to the 35-yard line. I want to correct the mistake I made earlier in the game. I said Dillon was a freshman. This is his first year at Washington, but he's a junior because he's a JC transfer. Now 2nd and 1 after the 9-yard gain. And Sheehy moves up on the wing as a blocker. Tooth put down on the carpet. Probably should have been held by Pathon.
Tim McTyre, the cornerback up there, is an excellent corner. You know, the other thing he does, I noticed in game tapes, is he's a vicious tackler. He can really hit people, and he enjoys it. Out of Los Angeles, California, Washington High School, he was a tailback in high school, more so than a defensive back, but he likes to hit people. That was an audible that time. He saw that coverage and went after it. A lot of poise for a redshirt freshman.
14-0, Washington. Sheehy jammed up in the middle that time by the Cougars. On a 3rd and 1, Harland Ayu jumps in with Omar Morgan to stack up the Husky running back.
You know, BYU is having a lot of problems right now defensing the slot formation with a wide receiver on the other side of the formation. They're spreading them out. And it's a very effective formation for the Huskies, and I'll be surprised if we don't see more of it. They have a nice formation package going for them. Jim Lambright here has got this offense going. It's the first year of this style of offense. They changed coordinators, changed the style.
1st and 10. Sheehy, patient, inside the 30-yard line.
They've got to get some pressure off the corner. People are able to slide along this line of scrimmage and bounce to the outside and pick up that 4 and 5 yard. Here it is, a 6-yard gain, a 5-yard gain. They have to get somebody in the running back space to turn it back inside to the rest of the people wearing white and blue.
Second and five, three wide receivers. Heward hands it to Sheehy. So this will leave the Huskies with a third and one here with a minute 14 remaining in the opening quarter. Sheehy with both of the Washington touchdowns. They lead BYU 14-0 in the opening quarter. Brock Heward, the younger brother of Damon, who was a longtime quarterback here in Seattle. Right back, Sheehy for the first down for Washington. Husky Stadium, where Washington has taken a 2-touchdown lead on unbeaten BYU. Seconds remaining in the opening quarter. Sean Sheehy scores both of the Husky touchdowns so far. Overcast morning, a drizzle in the air, but now the sun breaking out. Part of the great scene here.
Here's that formation again, taking the back out of the backfield. Why is that tight end? Got a great area to operate in.
Heward, incomplete. And that time, Jeremy Brigham, the intended receiver, ball was thrown high.
Yeah, Jason Walker, the free safety, got over there nicely, too. Had a little pressure on him. He had to get rid of the ball. Byron Frisch, 93, coming to the right top of your screens. He's coming around the outside there. They have a redshirt sophomore in over at that left tackle spot now, rather than Lynn Johnson. They moved in Aaron Dallin.
Henry Bloomfield took a crack at Heward that time as he got off the block just as he was throwing. The run, the toss was Sheehy being stretched out. There was a penalty flag, which perhaps you throw. There is McTyre with that hard hit over on the other side that Dick told you about.
Normally, in those kind of plays, when it's going outside, flag down usually means holding, and many times by the tight end. Let's see what they call it. Nope. Offside.
Offside on the defense, 5 yards from previous spot, receive second down.
Pretty balanced that way. 4 and 3. That's the good news.
Washington dominating BYU so far. Nothing doing because Spencer Reed, number 41, along with Byron Frisch, number 93, closed in. So that's the end of the first quarter. But the Huskies score touchdowns on their first two drives. Washington leading BYU 14-0. Start of the second quarter. Cougars with the ball. It's a 3rd and 9. The ball on the 22-yard line. Nice start. Husky mascot down there enjoying the sunshine. A lovely day to be watching a little football, looking at the cheerleaders, seeing what's going on.
BYU's got to make a commitment to get some pressure on them. They haven't gotten a sack this season yet in 2 ball games, but they got to get some pressure on this guy. Washington. Here they come up inside.
You're intercepted in the end zone. So the ball has been picked off by Jason Walker.
That's his first career interception. See, they stunted. They put pressure up inside. They brought the linebackers. You'll see the linebackers from number 46 on the right side of your screen, Muirbrook, 41, Spencer coming in. They're coming up inside. They do a nice job of picking that up. He throws it down the hole. The safety sitting there waiting for him, doing exactly what he's supposed to do, sit in that hole and wait for somebody to come in there. Nice play by Jason Walker. Take another look at it. Boy, has this guy got poise. See him sitting in that pocket like that. As he learns and matures, he won't throw the ball late down the middle.
Sarkisian and the Cougars take over right now. Dustin Johnson moves in motion for BYU. They run the delay. And I believe it was young McKenzie who got the call that time out for about a yard.
They tried to run the draw trap. I look for BYU Norm Chow offensive coordinator to get the ball to the wide receivers. Go ahead and test that coverage deeper. Even though maybe they aren't the fastest guys, those guys are averaging as a pair over 20 yards a catch. So they know what to do with the ball once they catch it. Norm Chow offensive coordinator has done an excellent job of directing this offense. As you said, Brent, you know, what, 99 points they scored coming into here? They need 7 now.
Second down and 10. Sarkisian calls a timeout. Again, the clock was about ready to run out, and he did not want to take the 5-yard penalty. So now we have seen coach twice that they've been a little bit slow on getting the play into the huddle. They use receivers as messengers.
Usually that's just decision making and substitution problems with multiple formations that you're delayed with. Taking a look, Washington doing what they wanted to do. Maintain some clock control, keep their offense on the field, their defense off the field. Look at the difference in the rushing yards. The O-line here is dominating that defensive front right now. They're just knocking them all over the field. And maybe BYU, this long trip, maybe they're not quite as emotionally ready to play. You know, they had a week bye. They didn't, you know, they had 3 days of practice 2 weeks ago. This week they started really getting after it. And LaBelle Edwards told me it was Thursday of this week before they seemed to get their minds back in and geared into the momentum that they were playing with when they took the bye.
Big difference in the game has been the performance of Rashawn Sheehy for the Washington Huskies. He has scored both of their touchdowns. One, a 45-yarder. Second down and 10.
These two corners, Jermaine Smith and Mel Miller, are both redshirt freshmen playing their second college football game, and they're playing with great confidence. They're defying them to go ahead and go deep. Looks like blitz. I don't know if they're doing it, but it sure looks it.
Huskies show that look, back out of it. Rush for Sarkisian. Offensive line holds up, but again, he can't find an open man. Has to throw to a safety valve.
And again.
So McGuire was the receiver, defended by Jerry Jensen, number 40. And this is just outstanding coverage so far by the Huskies.
It is outstanding coverage. But Keala Louie, number 3, he's going to walk back in that huddle and again complain. Listen, I'm wide open in the hole. Get me the football. That's the trouble with pressure in the quarterback space. He can't see everybody.
Third down and 5. Using Chad Lewis in motion over in the slot. They need to get the ball into his hands. And there is a diving reception now. And Kealahui came back to pick that one off. And it's a first down for BYU. 14-0. Run that little delay now. Atuhaya straight ahead, and that is a strong running play for the Cougars before Aliaga could bring him down. That's their best running play of the game so far, Dick.
That's the first time they popped real clean. They hit it really quick. And sometimes defensive linemen, especially the Husky defensive linemen, they read on the move. They don't sit back on their haunches. They attack, and they get too far off the shoulder of an offensive lineman, and it opens up that inside track. And that's what happened that time. Mark Atuhaya. Illegal formation. Yeah, he got him up there. They're not concentrating. They're sloppy. This is not the BYU team we saw against Texas A&M.
Dead ball. False start. On the offense. 5 yards. Still first down.
First off in that formation, an offensive receiver, wide receiver, didn't line up properly. So Steve Sarkisian's getting him lined up. Then his right tackle, Bateman, goes offside. and moves illegally. LaBelle will have a few nice things to say at halftime.
LaBelle's 300th career game as head coach at BYU today. Won 260. Just an amazing record. 12:30 to go now. Having trouble with this Husky defense here in Seattle. Rush five. But again, they were able to power to daylight that time. Out to the 47-yard line. And that again, McKenzie, the youngster, stepping in there. We've seen a couple of strong running plays right now by the Cougars.
Right. Important reason that time, Dustin Johnson, the fullback. Concentrate on the fullback in the middle of your screen, right in front of the tailback, number 32. Boom! He takes on John Fiala, number 57, and does a beautiful job of blocking. Real nice job by Dustin Johnson.
Second down and seven. Kalahui comes in motion over to the right side. Sarkisian steps away again. And completed it to Mealy, working on the near sideline. Aliaga, the defender there.
A lot of time to throw and no one to throw to. And this Mealy, you get the ball in his hands, 88 left side of your screen, as a talented, a big man receiver as we've seen in a long time. This guy has the mobility of a wide receiver. He's trying to shake their Ink Aliaga, number 54, and he finally does, but everybody else was covered in purple.
Well, here's third and four for the Cougars.
They must convert. They come into this ball game doing a real good job converting on third down.
The marker is at the 46-yard line. That's where the Cougars must reach to keep this drive alive. Deep. Got it. Fumble recovered by Lewis. And the Huskies are claiming incompleted pass. He did not hold on long enough for a completion.
He's on the right-hand side of your screen right here. He'll come off. He's got man coverage with the safety back there. Now Lewis is an All-American tight end. He has good mobility. Gives a little move to the inside. He turned him all away. Mel Miller, number 25, he turned him around. He just didn't do what he's supposed to do. Catch the football.
Punt. And Alan Boardman.
Nice punt.
Payton back deep again. Signals fair catch, and he makes the catch at the 13-yard line. Shane Fortney returns now to quarterback the Huskies. He led the Huskies to their two touchdowns, both scored by Sheehy. Heward in for that one drive, and of course, BYU intercepted him down in the end zone. Now 11:21 left in the first half, and Fortney is back in charge. And that is Mike Green. Jackaroo.
Brent, the one thing that Shane Fortney never leaves home without is right here. A lot of people know what it is. It's simple inhaler for people that are asthmatic. Now, it seems that Shane Fortney has suffered from what they call athletic asthma ever since high school. The one great thing, though, under the pressure of a game, he's never had to take a little spritz.
A little spritz.
A little spritz. I've heard that term before, but I don't think it was with one of those things.
Yeah, every now and then you're gonna like a little spritz. 14 zip now. Huskies with the ball. And clock had wound down to about 3 seconds. So this time it's Washington saving a 5-yard penalty. Here we've got the Cougars and the Huskies, and it's not the Apple Cup, because these are the Cougars of LaVell Edwards on what is turning out to be a gorgeous Saturday afternoon here in Seattle.
I asked LaVell Edwards about making the trip up here, and you know, the history of playing at Husky Stadium, and not many people are successful coming up here, and he said he really played it down, did not really make a big deal out of coming up here, but the weather, the fans, you know, the tradition of winning home games, he said just approached it just like another football game.
Second down and 8 for the Huskies. 10:44 remaining, first half.
Second down, 8 yards.
Shane Fortney, the starter. Back in. Sheehy, who has scored both touchdowns, goes over to the short side as a wide receiver off to the right. He was the flanker in this formation.
Come on,
Fortney, a good runner. A runner all day for the first down. stepped out of bounds at the 32-yard line. Planned play, showing you one of the things that he does very well.
That formation was a run pass option, and that you take the back out of the backfield, spread the defense out like that. The tight end Cameron Cleveland on the left hand side of your screen, you'll see him block down number 85. See, and then he'll pause and he'll come back out looking for the pass. No reason to throw it. He becomes a blocker downfield. But Fortney is not a typical quarterback. He's a 400 meter champion in high school. He can run.
First down, the ball out on the 33-yard line. Dillon, roll right again. And Fortney just tucks it away, and he'll take another 10 yards. There's a penalty flag down this time.
It worked good one time. Why not do it again? Same principle, same type play. Two flags down.
Jim Fogeltantz, Pac-10 crew sorting it out. Walt Wolf is his umpire. He's got the whole board of directors there. I mean, he's got every zebra in the neighborhood down there. This one going against the Huskies, both of them. Wow. They're sorting out this penalty situation. The only thing we know for sure is it's not good for Washington.
When Washington gets in that three receiver look with a flanker and then a slot away, I really believe BYU is going to have to kick the front over toward that tight end so they get a man in a contained position.
This ball is going to be taken all the way back inside the 10-yard line as a result of those two fouls. And now it is going to be first and 33 for Washington after the holding and the personal foul. That personal foul was a dead ball call, and that's why the officials just kept on walking it back. So now the Cougar defense, can they hold them in here? Can they bottle Washington up finally? They did that time. Strong defensive play by Lane Hale, who comes in to make the stop on Sheehy.
They slid the defense all the way over to that three receiver side of the formation that time, put a linebacker on the first wing back, rolled the strong safety at Lane Hale up there, and he made the play. Nice job by Lane Hale. Early in the ball game, they made this play go. You'll remember, ladies and gentlemen, he bounced to the outside and there were no white jerseys. Good adjustment made by defensive coordinator Ken Schmidt. He's got people up in their face now containing.
Janoski and Desisher in as wide receiver for the Huskies. Second down and 36.
Second and 36. What do you do, Brad? Quarterback.
That's exactly what Fortney wants to do, and they were spying on him pretty good. That's the man in the middle, Shea Muirbrook, making the stop.
The defensive tempo, in my opinion, looking at from the top looking down, has picked up here in this second quarter. They look like they're playing hard. The defensive linemen are coming off the ball a little bit tougher. They were a little bit sleepwalking here early in this first quarter. Maybe they had the wrong pregame meal.
Third and 32. Feeling a little fat-headed about that success against Texas A&M. Who knows? Huskies are tough here, that is for sure.
Formation all the way when they offset that back in the backfield.
And BYU backs off expecting. If it's a screen to Sheehy, they've got him wrapped up. Bloomfield coming over with a strong tackle. You gotta like that big fella, number 91.
He's an excellent player. Not only did he rush the passer on the screen, he comes off the rush and comes out and makes the tackle after the receiver catches it. That's effort football by Henry Bloomfield. Nice job, young man.
And now the Huskies are forced to punt. 8.5 minutes to go, and finally in a battle of field position, it's going to go BYU's way.
You know, maybe I can't use that expression, young man, very often on these guys. Some of them are 25, 26 years old.
Got to keep an eye now on this man, number 6, James Dye. Jeff Prince.
Lousy punt.
At the 5-yard line.
That's what happened to him in the fourth quarter, final punt of the game last week. He got an 18-yarder and ended up putting Arizona State in field goal position, and they made it.
We'll be right back. BYU playing with a short field right now, 43 yards away from scoring, and Ronnie Jenkins, the young man who rushed for better than 600 yards in one high school game, checks into that backfield now for the Cougars.
This puts Randy Hart, the defensive coordinator's Husky defense, in real tough position. Sooner or later, the Cougars are going to get that offense going.
Again, all that movement up front by the Huskies. Seven men across that front. Sarkisian steps away and wrapped up. He is sacked. Chorik was one of those in there with Jensen, number 40.
Jason Chorik, 13 tackles for a loss last year, led the team, 3.5 sacks. He's going to have a heck of a year. He came in with one sack in his first game. He, you know, he's an intense pass rusher. If he gets on your point, he gets outside edge on you, the right top of your screen. See, he comes around and he just keeps coming. He does not stop. He may not always be the first guy there, but if the quarterback has the ball in his hand, he's going to find him.
5-yard loss on the sack. Second and 15. Sarkisian rolling to the right. Mealy with his second reception of the game. Lewis still being shut out. Smith, the defender, number one.
Now they're still, you know, I still believe they've got to go ahead and dust them off. They're playing Jermaine Smith, one, the corner, Mel Miller, the other corner. They're playing up there, man-to-man, tight coverage on those guys, and they just refuse to throw the ball deep. Two fine wide receivers. Yes, not sprinters, but good receivers, great hands, as we both know, Brent. Each receiver has caught one pass so far. They aren't going to score any points until they get the ball in their hands. And it's not double coverage. It's single.
Third and 14.
Blitz.
Picked up. Deep side. Incomplete. And over there on that side, there is a penalty flag down. Kale Aluhi, the intended receiver. Sarkisian helped back off the carpet.
I believe it's roughing the passer. Sarkisian's a tough guy. He doesn't mind getting hit, but he doesn't want to get hit late.
Roughing the passer on the defense. 15 previous blocks. First down.
The guy we've been bragging about, Jason Chorik, gets on and hits him late. Comes from the right-hand side of your screen. The ball's gone. Now here it comes. Boom. No, it wasn't Jason. It wasn't Jason. That was number.
That was Josh Smith.
Josh Smith. Yeah. Here's the tight coverage I'm talking about. See, and he beats it to the outside, a little corner move. If he can get him the football, he's got a big play. Good approach. And that pressure forces you to miss those wide open receivers.
But the foul on Smith moves the ball to the Huskies 32-yard line here with 7.5 minutes to go. Can the Cougars finish this off? Five Husky defenders. You can see the slot man being pressed, and they'll run against that defense and nothing doing that time. David Ritchie, 97, made the stop.
They tried that same quick hit and play up inside and couldn't make it go. It's a little track play. They pulled the right guard, but they didn't get the tackle block backside. And David Ritchie, the center, has to block back and hold him on his own and couldn't get it done.
Boy, it's tough when you rough the passer on third and 14.
Yeah, that's not very smart football.
Second down and 10.
See, they're jumping that defense around.
Come off the stunt. Sarkisian, though, picks it up in the middle and gets the ball finally to McGuire. McGuire makes a punt. Touchdown, BYU.
So you run those crossing patterns against that man-to-man coverage, and you give him time to throw it, he's going to put it in the end zone. Typo McGuire coming all the way from the left side of the field. Good protection. Sarkisian only had to move a little bit. And then you know what happens? It makes you a little bit leery of playing those tight man coverages.
Now Pochman. Off to the right, but it was good. Not the cleanest, but McGuire scored. 32 yards on the touchdown. BYU on the comeback.
McGuire at the top of your screen here. He's going to come down and come underneath. Now the corner, Jermaine Smith, number one, is playing outside him because he has help inside, and he just crosses all over. They switched on him right there. And now watch the running move right here. Boop, boop, boop. He gives him a little footwork and into the end zone. Talented young receiver. Consecutive scoring games, NCAA record. That's a lot of scoring.
ball off the tee again from Hodgman. Dillon and Jarzynka back deep. There's a big win behind Hodgman right now.
Let it go out of bounds. Oh, it's not going.
It's going to be picked up. Mistake. It would have gone out of bounds by Dillon. He has that sideline, though, out to the 25-yard line. It's 14-7 as BYU comes back with a touchdown. And now it'll be the Huskies' turn. The ball at the 25-yard line. Shane Fortney. He led Washington to its only two touchdowns. And they use Reed straight ahead for 3 yards. Well, we got McGuire on a nice touchdown there, Jack.
Brent, we were wondering how he got his name. Well, it's actually shortened from Hawaiian, Kepianahoa. Now, what does that mean, Hawaiian? How about this, Brent? Handsome sweetheart. He looked pretty sweet going into the end zone, didn't he?
He gave him some sweet feet, I'll tell you that.
Easy for you guys to say. Second down and 8 now. Fortney fires to Payton.
He had a knee down. Not the ball, but his knee down. You know, I'd sort of like to see that changed in college football. You know, make somebody tackle you to move the ball dead.
Like the NFL.
Yeah, like the NFL.
That would allow running backs who slip on a wet surface
sure.
like they have up
yeah.
here to get back up and continue sure. to move as long as the official protects yeah. the player. Seems reasonable. There's Payton, number 24. He'll go out wide to the right side now. Gerald Harris, the freshman. I should say the newcomer to this Washington attack is in that slot. Fortney can pop it off incomplete, and Dillon, the intended receiver. There's the JC transfer. Dick, why is it that the JC youngsters are not necessarily real good receivers when they slip out of the backfield?
Well, you know, first off, they're not here in spring practice most of the time, so they don't get the receiving work. And in junior college, normally you see a lot of I formation stuff where they're handing the ball off. For a guy to run for 1,899 yards like he did last year, you got to hand him the ball often. Chances are they're not throwing it to him often.
It looks like they've changed punters now, too. Sarcher's first punt in college right now. Here's the heat. Ball rolls down at the 22-yard line. The Cougars have it back now. After that impressive scoring drive with McGuire taking it in from 32 yards out. Here's McKenzie, the middle, for 4 yards. Jackaroo, what about the BYU schedule if they can slip past this game?
Well, Brent, one of the problems, if you take a look at the schedule, is everybody was focusing on this game. They said, hey, if they can get by this game, it's a cakewalk all the way down to November 23rd. Now, some people disagree, but consider this fact as well. With the addition of this schedule, they get an extra game because they play Hawaii. They play in the WAC conference claim. They play in a bowl game, an NCAA record, 15 games in 1 year.
Got to get out of here first. And Sarkisian puts it into McKenzie's hands as he was going down under a savage pass rush that time.
Real pressure coming to the outside, and he felt the pressure coming. Not always can you see it from the left side there. And he moves over to the right and gets the ball laid off properly. Jason Chorik again coming from the top of the screen. They move him around. Here he is. See, that pushes him. That pushes him, and he gets hit late, but he gets the ball off.
He's played a good game, Chorik is.
Yes.
Sarkisian now comes up with a 3rd and 2. They'll throw the swing, and it's dropped by McKenzie, and it'll be 4th and 2. BYU must punt it away.
Again, trying to run with the ball before you catch, and he had purple jerseys coming inside out on right now, and he probably saw both the jerseys
and the ball coming at the same time. Very, very good defensive series by the Huskies that time.
Payton with Boardman punting. And the Huskies must be very uneasy about one thing right now, and that is their overall kicking game. It is starting to back up on them, isn't it? Caught at the 29-yard line. Payton with speed slips to the outside. Look out now. Boardman, the punter, got a hand on him, and he's finally run out of bounds, but not until he's into BYU territory, and the Huskies working with a lot of time left in the first half. 3:20.
Stevenson is their key guy normally. See, and he slips trying to come to balance on the AstroTurf. They better check what kind of shoes they have on. Well, the coach has said in every practice through training camp and spring practice, Payton came up with a big play whenever they scrimmaged. He came up with a big one then.
Three wide receivers off to Fortney's left, including Payton. Reed is the lone running back there behind him.
He's audibling right now.
And now Reed goes up on a wing. This is an obvious passing formation, and here comes. He snaps it off complete to Janowski at the 40-yard line.
Stay far away from the cars, partner.
Here's Reed, fullback, 30-yard line, first down.
That formation has hurt them. Every time they've done that, they've had a soft corner out there, meaning there is no defender right up in the receiver's face. Reed, I sat in and looking at game tape yesterday, and he was in there, and I asked him what he liked about football most, and he said, I like blocking most. Well, right now, it looks like he likes receiving.
That's a sure. One of the wide receivers shuttling plays in and out with Harris. Harris brought this one in, and he's down here to the short side. So this is a first and 10. The Huskies on the move. 2:20 to go here in the first half. Movement there in the middle by that defensive line. Could be again Reed. There is the penalty flag down. Dick, it could be Fortney's hard count or something, but yeah. The defensive linemen of the Cougars have jumped repeatedly here in the first half.
He's using that hard count, you know, and they're trying to get a little pressure. Emphasis has been made to pick up the tempo of the defensive line and pressure the quarterback. You get that hard sound, he's pulling them off.
I believe that's the third offside. And a reminder, the Chevrolet Scholarship Program. We'll have the Chevrolet Players of the Game coming up. You know, to date, Chevrolet has awarded nearly $6 million to the scholarship funds of America's colleges and universities.
Offside on the defense. 5-yard penalty from the previous spot. Repeat first down.
There's been some talk about calling the player who committed the fouls number like they do in pro back into college now. But
somebody, Jim Davis from Washington, came and told me that the Pac-10 had voted and they were not going to do it.
They
the athletic directors had voted against it. I don't know about the other conferences. I don't know. So it's a first 10. Ball inside the Cougars' 25-yard line. This is Big Reed powering into the middle now of that defense. And Jason Walker, who made a huge interception for the Cougars earlier in this half, making the stop.
The inside of the offensive line, Bob Sapp, 72, Orland Crouch, 77, Benji Olsen, coming off the ball, just man-to-man blocking, left side of your screen, no one pulling, no one trapping, just taking people on physically and knocking them back.
So the ball to the 11-yard line, and it's a first down for the Huskies. Power back attack with Reed in there. Continue to use him. Nothing doing. Okay. 2:00 Pacific time. Time running out on the first half here in Seattle. 14-7. Washington with the lead. They scored their two touchdowns on their first two series of the game. Then their backup quarterback had a pass intercepted. Meanwhile, Colorado with a touchdown pass from Detmer to Savoy regains the lead on Michigan as that's Donnybrook continues. Payton is out to the right. Cam Kissel down here to the left, the H-back. Reed now steps up on the wing. There's the passing formation. Payton at the 10, short of the first down.
BYU made the commitment to pressure with the inside linebackers, brought them at, and they had the pattern call that they had. It was a better call. I mean, just to go ahead and throw that quick out. They had the right call. So either giving him a little cushion right there, giving Pat Thunson respect. Just a little quick out, roll it out there, get the ball to him on time. See, that turf is a little bit slippery.
Yeah, that was a big question for the Cougars. Their footwear, they are definitely having traction problems here. Jackaroot.
Well, Brent, remember, they've changed some rules this year. Now you're only allowed, and it doesn't really apply on artificial turf, but you're only allowed certain choices in terms of the length of the cleats. Remember when we were covering the Illinois game last week, what happens is when it's inclement weather, you want to increase the cleat size and the number of cleats on the shoes. For BYU, they did that, especially for their linemen. But what happens, especially with this field, is as it begins to dry, the footing does become a little bit suspect. But by the end of the halftime break, I think you're going to see a dry field down here.
That's unusual.
Yeah, let's hope that the wind does dry it out. It's picked up a little bit, blowing from left to right as you're watching this game. There's Jim Lambright, his fourth year. You know, last night, Dick, I had an opportunity to go to the new racetrack outside of Seattle, Emerald Downs, and of course the president out there, Ron Crockett. He is a huge Husky fan and supporter of the program, but it was very nice that Ron had a first-time winner. Zealous.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, it was a wonderful win for him last night, and we certainly enjoyed being out there. That's a fine track.
I saw the police car pick you up and force you to go out there. Put the handcuffs on and said you're coming.
Son of a gun. Third down and one now. Sheehy to the 2-yard line. First and goal.
Nothing like having a running back can make the first guy miss. Rashawn tacks that on the lead play with a fullback carrying the lead blocker in front of him, and he just jumps by the first tackle.
Quickly, they jump up into it with 27 seconds to go. Huskies want a touchdown, don't want to settle for a field goal. Sheehy is short. They still have a timeout left.
Surprised they didn't throw the ball.
They have now used their last timeout. So it will be second and goal. Coach, with 18 seconds, that's plenty of time to throw the ball into the end zone. Or even with Fortney's running ability, you would really have to look for a quarterback draw or maybe go wide or something. Might not have enough room down here for the draw.
What they have in the game plan out of that same formation, a tight end, a split end with a wing back, they have an option where the quarterback fakes to the backup inside and comes off and has the option of either pitching it or carrying it in if they don't tackle him. That would be a very sound call.
Might as well use it right now.
Yeah.
No need talking about it on Sunday.
They also have a very nice little clever strong fake play action pass getting the ball to Cameron Cleland coming off the tight end position.
Well, the way they're talking to Fortney, look at him down there.
Yeah. That's Bill Diedrich, the quarterback coach, talking to him.
Time management, of course, becomes a factor here. Out of timeouts and 18 seconds to go. BYU will be looking for pressure here for Lavelle.
Get him ready, White.
Lavelle Edwards standing there with Chris Pella, his tight end and kicking coach.
Seconds with a second down and goal. And Fortney, short side, touchdown Washington. He kept it all the way. No question about that.
Yep.
That is going to be huge for Washington all season long. Inside the 10-yard line, Fortney's running ability adds a dimension to that offense and keeps pressure on your corner men defensively.
And it's tough on the inside linebacker when the quarterback puts that ball in the fullback's belly and makes that strong fake in there. That freezes the defense momentarily, and then with the speed he comes off that fake, and he has the option of turning up in for the score or pitching it out if they take him. They didn't get anybody in his face. He didn't have to pitch it. Just good strong running.
Wales in for the extra point. Fortney the holder.
Penalty against BYU is declined. Shane Fortney will hold.
You know, Dick, traditionally, over the last decade, Washington has received some outstanding play from its tight ends, and that has not changed here today or this season.
No, it won't with Cleveland. And watching the game tapes against Arizona State, he really blocked well. I talked to him on the practice field the other day, and he said he hopes they bring him into the passing game a little bit more, but he is really blocking well right now.
21-7 on the Fortney touchdown. And take a look at exactly what Dick is talking about.
Number 85, big tight end, 260 pounds. When he gets in your face, he's a man, and that's a fine linebacker he's on. But see, he bends his knees and he gets pressure and he sticks and stays. Good job. And today in college football, they use the hands so much more than they used to. Legally.
Final 13 seconds of the first half.
That's a late score. They just announced that. They just announced the Colorado score is 7-3 in favor of Michigan. And keeping up there with the PA system. At Colorado, as you and I know, good football team. They have some speed at those receiver positions. They're going to put points on the board. That was a big play in more ways than one for the Huskies to get that score right before the half. Takes a little sap out of the BYU team that didn't come with a lot of zip in that first quarter anyway.
Wales. They kick it off this time with Jenkins and Dye back, and there's 13 seconds remaining.
Kicking into the wind.
Put it into Jenkins' hands. Wrapped up at the 30-yard line.
Ikaika Malo, number 20. Very good defensive player, very good tackler in special teams. That was a nice, nice tackle.
Seven seconds. Shotgun. Whistle. There was time left on the snap.
These officials have been busy in the first half.
Yep.
Either that or they like to chat.
Yeah, we've had some sloppy play here in Seattle today.
Dead ball. Illegal formation. In the neutral zone on the offense, 5 yards. Timer, 7 seconds to be on the clock. 7 seconds. Thank you.
Final 7 seconds in the first half. Three rushing touchdowns for the Huskies. Incomplete and a penalty flag.
Holding. Sarkisian gives a signal.
Well, coach, don't you think BYU should be content right now just to flop on back in and huddle up and try to regroup here in the second half?
Well, I believe BYU has the ability to come back once they start getting the ball in the hands of their wide receivers.
Holding on the offense, 10 yards, spot of the foul. It's first down.
They've also maybe got to find a way to do a little better job of blocking Jason Chorin, because he's the guy that was held that time, and he's giving them more pass rush than they have had to compete against in the last two ball games. Those tackles are good, but he's challenging them.
That'll do it. Washington will take a 21-7 lead. Dick Vermeil, I'm Brent Musburger. Washington leading BYU at the intermission 21-7. Rashawn Sheehy was the big offensive star for the Huskies. Here he is on his second touchdown. Little misdirection, steps to the left, 45 yards. Sheehy carried the ball 16 times for 92 yards overall, and this is his second score. But then, Dick, back finally came the Cougars for their only touchdown.
Well, they finally got the ball in the outside receiver's hands, and this guy, not the fastest, but he's very nifty. See, they're chasing him across the field. He come up, and he's going to make you miss. Stutter the step right here. Bang, bang. And he's in the end zone, and he loves to get in the end zone. He does it often. Taking a look at the halftime stats, you can see time and possession really here, plus five. That's what Washington wanted to do. They're dominating the running game with 114 more yards rushing. Dominating in every way so far. BYU sort of out of sync in the passing game with only 71 yards passing. You have to credit the Husky defense, tight coverage.
Shane Fortney, the starter, and was impressive. He scored the Huskies' third touchdown, running it in. He was their second leading rusher of the first half with 42 yards. Interesting that Sheehy had more yards running than Sarkisian did passing. Sarkisian 8 of 14 for 71 yards passing. And there you can see from the BYU play chart that they finally were able to score their touchdown on a four play drive.
And that's after the bad punt, you know.
But Jenkins and Dye will go back deep, and the Cougars will handle it here to start the second half.
Number 48, Randy Jones, will kick off for the Huskies.
Randy Jones puts the ball on the tee for the Huskies. BYU standpoint, it is important for them to get off to a positive start here early in the third quarter. From a Husky standpoint, they want the same kind of rock'em sock'em defense they showed in the first quarter.
I think the Huskies, the coaching staff, and the players have gained a lot of confidence in their defense. They were shook after that Arizona State game last week and given up 45 points.
Jenkins.
Boy, he brings it out, doesn't he?
To the 28-yard line. Sarkisian brings the offense in. What about his receivers in the first half, Dick?
Brent, they're just not getting the ball to those two guys. They came into the ball game with 18 receptions between them. Look at that, 24.9 average, five touchdowns. And now, they've in this ball game, they've had three receptions so far for 45 yards, one touchdown. They've got to get the ball in their hands.
They're down to the short side, which is the left side of the field. Complete. Mealy matched up wide. They flexed the tight end out wide to the right. Sarkisian takes a shot and he's helped back up.
See, they use Mealy both as a tight end and an H-back.
Sarkisian shaking up just a bit as he takes this hit. He comes up just a little gimpy.
Yeah, and that's Torek again, number 46. And boy, that hurts because he had his forward leg planted like that. He's a tough guy, but that, boy, that left leg gets banged up. It's tough to throw well. Better the left than the right.
Now this time it is Dye, James Dye, who's off to the left, and he's matched up one-on-one. There's great speed out there. Sarkisian's looking, and Dye's got it. He steps out of bounds with a penalty flag down at the 49-yard line. In fact, there are two penalty flags down. The Huskies indicating that it's going to go in favor of them, and Sarkisian says, no, it's not.
Oh.
Then we had a little roughing the passer.
See, they're proving right now that they can throw the ball against tight coverage. Here's Dye, number 6. It is tight coverage. Jeremiah Smith doing a good job. And, you know, it's tough to cover a guy one-on-one with that much room to the outside of the field. Look forward to make a little move out and go.
I think you can hear in the background they're going to replay this. There was the roughing the passer call.
That was David Ritchie.
So they offset, and it'll be first and 10. Sarkisian bringing him up to the line of scrimmage. Second clock will not start until the umpire steps out of there and the officials say that everything is in order here. Let's see what the ref is going to tell us.
The two clocks aren't.
Timer, we got to get the clocks set.
Yeah, one's 1:48 and the other's 43.
14:48 on one clock and 14:43 on the other.
There's three.
There's the three. Let's go to the other side.
Yeah, the other side is eight.
Yeah.
And let's make it eight.
Yeah.
Very polite here in Seattle. They gave the Cougars a few extra seconds. Now first down.
Well, I tell you, sometimes with that much of a delay, you're better off going back into the huddle, Brent.
Or the locker room.
You're the locker room. They're sagging.
Four men down. Run the delay. Johnson, nothing doing. There's number 57, John Fiala eats him up.
That draw trap delay hits a little bit slow for this kind of a defense. You can usually get the trap on the defensive end, but Fiala, very smart football player, District 8 academic All-American. He was a walk-on, and he shows he can walk on, but he can also tackle. He's now on scholarship, making a real big play.
Atuea. Again at running back, and again the clocks.
Let's just turn
one
of them off, boys.
Up. One of them says 22, and the one to our left says 40.
Just an official timeout. We got a clock problem here.
Well, let's just determine which one is right. Turn the other one off. That isn't too difficult.
Well, the BYU Cougars, when you think of some of the offensive minds who have graduated from Air Edwards, Doug Scoville, Ted Tallner, Mike Holmgren, they certainly come to mind. Holmgren now doing such a good job with the Green Bay Packers. But it all began over in Provo, Utah, under Lavelle Edwards.
The system just keeps going on.
George Hill suggests that one of these clocks is Pacific time and the other's mountain time. The official time says 14:06. Off to our right, that opening. Sarkisian comes back underneath, and another penalty flag is thrown. Johnson to the 45-yard line, but the referee threw the flag back at the 35, and back it comes. Stepped free from Jermaine Smith, who had coverage on him, and Jermaine finally makes the stop at the 42-yard line. That's about back at the original line of scrimmage.
Here's, you got the one-on-one coverage. See, he's playing outside because he has help inside. Nice little move to the outside. Good throw right on time. Good rhythm. And Jermaine Smith would like to get some help underneath. He's getting help with some good pass rush, good pressure. They have to throw it there, but there's a nice throwing lane to step up into.
Split backs. And no tight end and timeout. There was plenty of time. So this was not because the 25-second clock was running out. Sarkisian saw something he didn't like that time.
Protection called with the pattern and saw the front and didn't like the front the protection was going to have to handle, so he stopped it right there. Gets over and talks to Norm Chow, the offensive coordinator, about it. It's obvious, though, at halftime they've adjusted offensively and they're going to get the ball in the hands of the wide receivers.
Long time defensive assistant here in Seattle, Jim Lambright. Over following the very successful tenure of Don James. His fourth year, he has not been beaten in a home opener here in Seattle.
You know, and the job he did last year in tying for the Pac-10 championship with only 65 guys on scholarship due to the NCAA penalties, that's an outstanding job. 65 guys.
Hasn't been in the same kind of rhythm. We saw him in earlier this year in Provo.
No, he certainly has not. Got to credit the defense. Randy Hart, the defensive coordinator, and his staff have done a real good job. There's still some things there for them to do. Between penalties and other things like that, they haven't gotten it done.
Third and nine. The Huskies may be coming off the corner. Here they come. They got a man open, Sarkisian underneath, but the pressure was the reason why, and now there's a penalty flag. Dye may have been pushed off downfield. Let's see, it was thrown in his direction.
Coverage. He's going to try to get up to the outside. Now Jermaine, number one, is a, see, he's got his left hand him. Yeah, there's no question. You can't do that. Good call.
Once that ball's in the air, coach, you got to disengage.
Yeah, you bet. Plus, you can't grab a hold of a jersey. You can punch with that hand, but you can't grab and hold. Just a red shirt freshman. Came here as a running back. Did a real good job at Royal High School.
Pass interference on the defense. 15, first down.
Boy, that made up for that holding penalty. Yeah. Jim Lambright doesn't like that call. Coaches never like the calls that go against them.
Well, you know, they were so slow in marching that off that I think Lambright thought it was the next play. That's amazing.
Yeah, it is. They're still debating.
I mean, let's get on with it.
Both clocks are in sync.
May join primetime tomorrow night.
Boy, this really slows down offensive football team. Oh my gosh.
First and 10 now. The ball is at the Husky 41-yard line. Step back out and rush four this time against Sarkisian, who hits underneath and he puts it in Atue's hands, and Atue crashes inside the 30-yard line. You have now, you've got to admire what Chow and Lavelle have done here at halftime, because this is much more wide open. Sarkisian seems a little more confident. Let's see if he can finish this off.
Plus, the other thing has happened is they forced the Huskies to go into a little different coverage scheme. That time they were in a two deep. They gave him a lot of time to throw. He read the coverage properly and laid the ball off. He didn't go downfield with it, but the zone allowed him to lay it off.
Dick Ritchie was causing the center, Larry Moore, a lot of problems that time. Mealy snaps it down, and he slips at the 25-yard line. That's a 4-yard gain before he went down. So again, we see a Cougar losing his footing.
Right. And you mentioned Richie. You know, he's a big 6'5" guy on a 6'3" center. He can give him some problems. He's an intense pass rusher, number 97, middle of your screens. He's working up inside. He lays this off nicely. Now you notice it's a zone coverage. They're not tight man to man. He just slips and falls. Look for him now to jump back into the man.
Second and 6 for Lavelle Edwards in offense.
Here's the tight coverage.
That's the backs. Bring an H back in motion, and look at that pressure from the Huskies, but they only rush four as they drop back out. Sarkisian to the end zone, incomplete.
Wow.
That was Dye crossing between two, and Parrish was one of the defenders back there, and he appears to be down on the carpet.
They ran into each other. He would have intercepted that football. Nice read by Parrish, and 25 Mel Miller, the redshirt freshman, is down for the count here.
Boy. Let's take a listen to this collision right now. Oh!
Whoop!
I mean, they slammed into each other.
I hope he is not banged up badly, because they're really thin at the corner position. When you're starting two redshirt freshmen at corner, you don't have much depth. And they're playing well.
take another look from the other side. Crossing pattern. Contact will be made right hand corner. Here it comes. Wham! Parrish would have intercepted it. He would have intercepted it. What time of day is it? Where are we? Yeah. Wow. He's their best coverage guy too, as well, and he's a safety. He runs on their track team. He's got a lot of speed.
Third and six, and remember, because the two received medical attention, they have to go out at least for this play. So one half of the starting backfield has been knocked out on what the Cougars are looking at now. It is third and six. So if the brain trust upstairs, Quinn, can pick out the weakest of the links right now, the Cougars might be able to quickly strike here. Let's see what happens now. The front of Washington knows that they could be in trouble in the back. They'll try to get enormous pressure on Sarkisian. Taylor Louis steps off over here to the left. Chorick coming through, pressures the passer. It was Jason Chorick who got heat on Sarkisian that time.
Did a good job of getting his inside forearm, inside shoulder pad underneath Big John Tate. Right there in the middle of your screen, 46 on John Tate. Right, see, he gets that arm underneath him, and he couldn't get him pushed away.
Chorick's speed has been a big factor in this game defensively. So Potchman will attempt the field goal. It'll be a 42-yarder. Boardman, the punter, will put it down. So the transfer from Washington to Provo puts three up on the scoreboard. It's 21-10. The Washington Huskies still lead. We have three rushing touchdowns by the Huskies on the first two series, 4 yards and 45 yards by Sheehy. Then Fortney on their last drive of the half goes the final 1 yard. That's the Huskies' three touchdowns. They lead it 21-10. Jarzynka and Dillon are back deep. Potchman. Dillon fields it at the 4-yard line. Dillon to the 25, to the 30-yard line. Jackaroot, how are those two defensive players from Washington who were shaken up?
Well, Brent, they certainly were. Mel Miller is right behind me, and what they've done is he's bruised his right knee. They have iced it down, and they are certainly going to keep him out at least for a couple of series. The same thing with the other fellow that was involved. He is, the trainer has told me that he suffered from a concussion. Now, they talked to him a little bit, but they're going to keep him out for several series. So, as you said, that's two of their key defensive players out at both at the same time.
Look at the defensive lineman slant on the Husky center right now. Watch the middle of the BYU defensive line. Fortney to Sheehy, forced to step out to the left-hand side, and he is wrapped up just short of the 35. Second down now. Fortney starts Sheehy into motion. No running backs in the backfield. Stands incomplete, coming back to Janoski the other side.
Good tight coverage by Lane Hale. Lane Hale started the Texas A&M game at the strong safety position. Today they started Chris Ellison. But Fortney has been too much for him. 42 yards rushing, 94 yards passing, total offense 136. No turnovers on his part. Good job.
You liked the young man in practice. You've watched him a couple years.
Yeah, and I you know, he was just too good a player on the practice field to not eventually be able to transfer that kind of effort at the game day.
Third and six now for Fortney and the Huskies. Slot man, you can see, is to the left.
Here's a change-up defense that they haven't seen.
Fire that way, incomplete. Big defensive series for BYU. It does not give those two injured Huskies much time to recover over there, and Lambright must give it up now on fourth down. Dick, we saw an unusual sight with the punter during intermission while everybody was watching John at with the halftime highlights.
Yeah, out there warming up, and kicker out there kicking punters. Oh, my gosh. That's a unique experience to see a guy at halftime with no one else out on the field.
Well, the leg is warm. Prince is ready, but so is Dye. He led NCAA Division 1A with returns. This one boomed to Dye. Dye going to field it at the 23-yard line. Going to elude the first man. Cuts back now to the 30, down just short of it. BYU trailing 21-10. They'll have the ball first down on their own 30-yard line. And Parrish, who was shaken up, has checked back in the game. But Dick, the corner over there, Miller is still out. Now, who will fill in for him?
Alex Hollowell, number 15, a Glendale, Arizona junior college transfer. Second-team All-American. He has good playing experience in junior college, not here at this level.
Huskies show pressure, but only rush four. Sarkisian stands tall, fires complete. And that time, they put the ball in the hands of Chad Lewis. I believe that's his first reception of the game.
Well, he dropped one in the first half. I know that. That time, the Huskies went to a two-deep defense changeup, got out of their pressure mode, and you don't fool Steve Sarkisian. He reads those kind of things, and he takes the layoff people, attacks those underneath coverages real well.
So it's a six-yard gain on first down for BYU. Lewis now and Sarkisian coming up to the line. Time left in the third. And there's the penalty flag, comes flying again.
You know, I wonder if the Huskies defensive line and linebackers aren't calling some kind of a command to shift their defense. You notice them moving them all the time because they're getting those offensive linemen to move.
Dead ball, false start on the offense, 5 yards.
Jackaroo.
And Chad Lewis was considered too skinny, believe it or not, for Division I football out of high school. But like most Mormons, he went away on a mission. And when he came back, he gained a lot of weight. And the Utah coaches said they'd offer him a scholarship. But then the Utah coaches left. So he ended up at Brigham Young. He's 26 years old. That's what mission work will do for you.
We got a story about a mission and Jim Lambert. Let me watch this snap first here. Second and nine. Sarkisian back, fires, and it's McGuire steps out of bounds. First down. Nice play for the Cougars. On his news conference, Jim Lambright said that he told his young freshman defensive backs, "We are on a mission this week, and it's not to Finland."
I think they got the point because they've been playing awfully well. He's a very matter-of-fact coach. There's no way to misunderstand what's on his mind.
Certainly not. All at the 46-yard line. Split backs now for the Cougars.
Pressure defense. Jumping to the bare front. Audibly.
You can see the look.
Go deep for the football.
And Sarkisian looking. Not going to get it off. Sacked at the 35-yard line. His wide receivers down here, they were blanketed.
Absolutely covered like a blanket, just like you said, Brent.
Burton and Smith with coverage back down deep, and I mean there was nothing doing.
Here's Chorik, number 46. Takes an inside rush. They run the stunt, and he just keeps coming, and so does everybody else keep coming. Good intense pressure by Mac. I got that screw around.
Want to try it again, Dick, or yeah. What?
Well, I'll tell you, you read these names. Tui Aaya, okay? Six letters, five of them are vowels.
That's good on the second try. Second down and 19 now. Sarkisian back again. Going to have a lot of room to run. Sarkisian steps out of bounds at midfield, but this will leave now about 5 yards for the first down. About a 14-yard run for the BYU quarterback as we come to the top of the hour right now with 8 minutes and 30 seconds left in quarter number three. Only a field goal. That's the point production here in the second half. It was 21-7 Washington at the half. Cougars have kicked a field goal right now. They're down 21-10, and let's make it third down and 5 yards to go for the first down. Pressure complete, first down, across the 40, and there's Kalaluhi out of bounds. Parrish runs him out, but a big third down play for the Cougars that time as they cross the 35 and they're on the move again.
Designed not to get the big play, designed to get the first down. Convert that third down situation. Straight, quick drop back pass, 1-2-3, throw it, lay it out there quick. Tight coverage inside. They're moving inside. Now that's a safety. Parrish that went out in the ball game just a little while ago with a slight concussion. Back in playing tough football.
The Cougars definitely picking up the pace here in the second half. Washington rushes for Sarkisian to the right. Fires complete. This is Lewis. bangs off a would-be tackler to the 16-yard line. That was Alex Hollowell. He's the sub defensive back over there, number 15.
Boy, they're hurting. Well, those two guys made contact, and Lewis is coming out. Boy, they real contact made on that one. Good play action. That pressure defense. You'll listen to this collision. You can maybe hear that one. Wow. Could hear that one from up here.
I could hear you. First down and 10 now. The ball at the 16-yard line. They wanted to hand off against that pressure that Johnson, and they're lucky they didn't fumble the ball right there. A defensive lineman came clean, Jason Chorick, and he was reaching for the ball that time, but Johnson hung on. Jack.
Wide receiver Capo McGuire was over on the sidelines, Brent, and what they did, if you take a look at his right arm, there it is. You can see that there's a bandage there on his right arm. He was suffering from severe cramps. So what the trainer did is they introduced by injection some calcium, and immediately it took the cramps away.
Second and 9. Could have handed him a banana. Now Sarkisian under enormous pressure. Steps away, fires, and drops it incomplete. Oh, baby, he was coming out of the pressure by stepping up through it that time.
Yeah, real courage. He stepped up inside. His offensive guards did a good job of keeping the defensive rush away from him in the middle, but that hard outside rush, they're not doing a good job of that hard outside. Kailua now at number 3. They like the crossing patterns down inside here in the red zone. They switched off on him. He's tight coverage now. The inside defender picked him up. That's Nigel Burton, number 8. Does a good job.
If BYU doesn't hit this third down, they'll go for the field goal. That would leave it 21-13. That decision's already been made on the sideline. Split backs now.
They're screwed up on defense over here. They were.
Fires open, incomplete for a fraction of a second. McGuire was open, but I want to tell you that Jermaine Smith, that redshirt freshman defensive back, number 1, has played some game back there on the corner today, and here comes Potchman.
They'd have snapped that ball just a few seconds earlier. They had the slot down to the short side of the field, and they were not covering the slot. He was uncovered completely.
33-yard left hash mark. Closer actually to the middle of the field. No good. Big miss.
Big critical miss.
Husky fans can breathe a whole lot easier. All right. First down now for Fortney and the Huskies. Both Dillon and Sheehy are in. Sheehy is a wide receiver, and Fortney's going to roll in that direction. Around to the right. On the run, hits his tight end to the 33-yard line. Put the ball in Cleland's hand.
That same play that they earlier ran the ball on. You'll see the tight end right here. This is a running back out here. That really spreads the defense. Now they make the inside fake and then come out. Tight end blocks and delays and come out. It's an option runner pass. This time they threw it. Earlier in the game, he ran it for a nice game.
12-yard gain on the play. And Fortney, after the disappointment of a week ago against Arizona State. Tough conference opener down in Tempe. And it looks like Arizona State, as we watch the Huskies today. Arizona State must have a very good team. That's Reed stepping out to the left-hand side of your screen. This is Sheehy in the middle. Sheehy close to a 5-yard gain there on first down with Muirbrook making the stop.
He's a good football player. He came into the ball game with 265 career tackles. He's been all WAC conference, number 46 right there, the right side of your screen. He's working back in there, so he gets his pads into him, then gets some other help, but Sheehy's still moving the ball upfield.
100 yards and 2 touchdowns for Rashawn Sheehy, averaging better than 5 yards a crack. He's the lone running back there behind Fortney, with Janoski coming to motion, and now they look for the motion man incomplete.
Yeah.
So it'll be now 3rd down and 5.
Well, the history of the Huskies with 100-yard rusher in the backfield, they win 80% of the time. Here's the graphic. You know, in the National Football League, it's almost the same, Brent. It's about 75% win with a 100-yard running back.
And
this guy, good, a lot better football player today than he was last week against Arizona State. Same kind of player I saw start against Notre Dame here last year and had a big game for 171 yards. Did a super job.
The big back, Reed, now the running back. The wideouts there two at the top of your screen. Now it goes empty with Reed in motion. Deflected, almost intercepted off the deflection, but it falls incomplete. And again, Washington forced to punt. Dick, the offense sluggish here. That's three and out for him.
Maybe getting a little too fancy. You know, maybe you ought to get back in there and run the little ball a little bit more. Now, see, they're getting up there. Good jump reach there that time by Ayu, number 90. Hey, I got that one right. Ayu, A-H-Y-O-U, Ayu. Ayu did a good job.
Jeff Prince, back to punt. Die on a big bounce. Has to pick it up. Dangerous, but he still got it. He makes the most of it. He comes free. He's in the middle now. Watch this speed to the 43-yard line.
That's why he was Special Teams Player of the Year in the WAC Conference. Averaged 21.9 yards per return. Led the country. Daring, courageous, tough type of runner. Very elusive. Normally you give a person the opportunity to take one shot. They took the one shot, but they didn't knock him down. See, he just makes people miss. He makes good tacklers miss. So you have to come to balance when you cover this guy. Surrender a few yards, break your knees, come to balance, widen your base.
38-yard return for Dye, who stays in as a wide receiver down there toward the bottom of your screen. The slot man. How big is that missed field goal now? Across the 45-yard line, Sarkisian coming back at a man open. There's a penalty flag. It's Dye. Dye spins free to the 25, but there is a flag down.
Chorik is sitting down on the field at the 47-yard line giving the holding signal. They're trying to block this guy. Rather than hold him, they better give the tackle some help. I didn't believe coming into the ballgame they'd need help. But by gosh, this guy is really giving them all and more than they can handle. You can take a tight end and chip and release and bump into him. You can take a running back as he releases and bump into him.
Holding, offense, 10 yards from the start of the foul. Repeat the down.
See, they've tried to trap him too as well. Here he is at the bottom of your screen, number 46. He's going an underneath charge. See, and he just keeps coming. Now he's laying on the ground. And he just gets up. See, he gets up off the turf, and then he gets it. The only way to stop him is to shoot him. He is so competitive.
First down.
I didn't mean that, Mom and Dad.
I know you did. First down and 24. Almost intercepted on the deflection off Johnson's hands.
You know, I don't think he was actually throwing it to him. He was throwing the ball to the tight end who's working outside him. And the flare control got in the way. He was throwing it there, and John Fila got in the way.
Second down and 24. Well, the football game has turned around a bit here in the second half, but the Cougars have been unable to make the most out of their opportunities. Here's a second and 24.
They're not covered properly here. Look at the slot down at the bottom. Nobody on it.
There was 2 seconds left on the clock.
Prior to the snap, illegal snap on the offense.
Another mistake.
Repeat second down.
The Cougars trying to make the most right now of a second and 29. Sarkisian comes up firing up. Ace and Mealy takes off right over the top, and he had stepped out of bounds at the 42-yard line. And Mealy running the intermediate hurdles.
I guess you have to tackle him high. What an athlete. 250-pound tight end. Look at that move. Right up over the top of young Kyle Roberts, a redshirt junior strong safety. Got to get up a little higher than that man. boy, what an athlete. One of the most impressive athletes I've seen in the last few years playing football in college.
Left the Cougars with a 3rd and 9 following that 20-yard gain. So here's 3rd and 9, BYU. The stunt comes free. And again, Sarkisian is sacked. That was David Ritchie, number 97.
See, the defensive left tackle and nose guard, stunted to the right, and the right tackle came on around, and they picked him up, but allowed penetration up in the middle. And there's Ritchie, number 97, right there. And that's Chris Campbell, 35, getting the heat.
Now Boardman. There's the penalty. Boardman is roughed. Now if it was just running into the punter, it would not give them the first down. So that's the preliminary sign, is just running into him. Because it was 4th and 17.
Against the receiving team, 5-yard penalty.
Yep.
I actually think they should have called that 15-yard. I mean, they knocked him off his feet. That's more than just a love tap.
And I'll tell you, Lavelle Edwards is agreeing with you down there on the sideline, but they're also making the decision of what to do, and if they want to repunt this one.
The other thing it puts it at
5-yard kicker, hit the defense, be 5 yards, repeat 4th down.
So Boardman will do it all over again.
5-yard.
So Payton will be standing back on the Husky 10-yard line. And it looks like they'll back off this time. And the Huskies do just that. Boardman hangs it. Payton's going to signal fair catch and hope it goes into the end zone, but the Cougars have not knocked it out. They didn't save it. Goes into the end zone, and it'll come out on the 20. Very close. Stevenson got down there in good shape. Good-looking, handsome Malamute. Did you ever notice how he likes to look at the camera? He's like Jack a Root. He always knows where the camera is. Huh? First and 10 now for the Dogs. Fortney sprinting to the left. He's got room and speed. 11 yards.
See, with a quarterback like that, that's better than a reverse or a counterplay handed to the running back. Think of that kind of speed. You make that fake, you freeze the defensive end down to the inside, and then get him outside there. Boy, that's really tough. You really have to be disciplined as a defensive end or outside linebacker to stay at home and make sure he doesn't have the ball coming out there.
Broke completely free, tripped up at the 40. This will be 2nd and 2 on an 8-yard gain.
Boy, did the offensive line come off inside. Boy, they came off inside going like a son of a gun up there. The offensive line was blocking real well. Good block by Sapp, 72. Johnson, number 57, tries to get the cut block on him, and just a little bit late, cut on the linebacker. If he'd have stayed up and gotten his face, he might have been able to break that play.
3 minutes, 3rd quarter, 21-10, Washington over BYU. Washington scoreless here in the 2nd half.
You got it.
Sheehy on a cutback. Stretches it, 1st down plus. 44-yard line. First down, Washington. Jackaroo.
Well, Brent, when you watch Xi there, you might be reminded of his hero, Walter Payton, in more ways than one. Xi read somewhere that Walter used to run hills as he prepared for his NFL career. Well, let me tell you what Xi does. He runs the hills here in Seattle. Now, he started it in L.A., but what he did is he had to change the hill that he ran this year because there was too much traffic. And he gave me the directions. He says, you start at Ravina, you go up 54th Street, you go to 22nd Avenue. I'll tell you what, I was out of breath after writing them down.
I believe you.
First down for the Huskies inside the 45-yard line. This time, Xi slams that hill pretty well. Slammed out of bounds at the 38-yard line. Another big-time run by Xi. That was Ben Cook who took him out. He stepped in there for McTyre.
Spencer Reed, 41, the outside linebacker, did a nice job of making him bounce back and go the other way, but they didn't have anybody coming upfield to contain anything coming backside. I wouldn't be surprised to see the Huskies have Shane Fortney run that counter again and keep the ball. Nobody out there. He might as well keep it going.
Dessa Sure playing a wide receiver. He missed the Arizona State game. Payton out wide to the left. Now Reed steps up over there to the left. Payton has it first down, Washington.
So he's audible into that when he sees that single coverage out there back off the ball. Dessa Sure is extremely fast. He runs on the track team here. One of the fastest men on the team. One of the faster kids in school.
First down for Washington. The ball is at the 31-yard line. Janoski slotted right. Nice drive the second half by the Huskies so far. Reed is cut off, but he still powers to the 28-yard line. That's a 3-yard gain for Reed.
Real nice play by Henry Bloomfield, the defensive tackle. You've called his name a number of times today. And he earns those calls. He's working very hard. They doubled him initially with that blocking scheme, but he broke one of the tackles and moved inside out.
So we have an injured Husky that could be Cleland.
It's 85. He's fought his way up through the ranks to earn the opportunity to be the head coach here.
37% of the games played in Husky by a Husky football team he's been involved in. That's a lot of football games as a player, an assistant coach, and now a head coach. Glad to see that guy stand up and walk off. He's really made a commitment to become a better football player. You know, he's also a fine baseball player and has had played baseball here, Brent. And he gave up baseball to concentrate on tight end position because he has seen these kids leave here and get these huge contracts going to the NFL. And he said, you know, I may not be able to play in the majors in baseball, but I think I can play in that NFL. I like the size of those contracts.
There is a statistical measurement. What that does not show you is how much better Fortney runs than Sarkisian, at least in this game. Second down and 7. Fortney looks back to the left, goes end zone, got a touchdown, Janoski. Great patience by Fortney.
Patience and poise, another P word, patience and poise. Last week that he did not have that. Today that he has it, and the fact that he ran the play action fake and pump trying to get the ball to the tight end. He wanted to throw it to Jeremy Brigham to the right side. That pulled the safety over there. Now he had one-on-one going down the hole in the slot, and he picks him out and lays it in there.
Dick McTyre has been out on this drive, and Cook is over there on that corner. Badly, no good. That leaves Brigham Young 17 points down. Well, the Washington Huskies gave up 45 points in their opener, but only 10 here today. And Dick, this may have done it for them.
Well, they wanted to throw the ball to tight end here, and the fact that he faked to him, pulled the safety over there and gave him that hole right there. Now watch the safety to the right side of your screens. He went for the tight end. There he is going back there. Good poise by Fortney.
Jones kicking it off. Fielded by Shortman at the 20-yard line. And line, still maneuvering to the 35, 40. Terrific return by Ned Stearns, number 33, a backup running back. Well, this was the practice and didn't seem to do much good after that botched extra point.
That's how much time was left at the halftime. He nailed that one.
But missed an extra point, 27-10, but that Cougar missed field goal. The difference would be 14 points right now, but now it's going to take three scores. Down 17, trailing 140. But they've got to find a way to score more points. That's unusual to be saying that about a BYU offense. So they run against the pressure, and the Huskies are ready as Kyle Roberts comes up from that rover spot. What a great defensive play. Jackaroo.
Right behind me is Cameron Cleveland. Now he's sitting in with the coaches right now. You can see the ice on the back of his neck. He received a stinger. But let me update you on the condition of Brock Huard. Huard took a spear to the base of his back in that one series of downs that he played in the first half. Don't look for Huard to come in any kind of a mop-up operation. The physicians here say he's most likely out for the game.
27-10. Four down linemen for the Huskies. Sarkisian fires high, incomplete. Neely, the intended receiver.
Boy, they're just doing an excellent job.
Check that, it was Lewis.
Excellent job with their coverage. He's changing it up just enough. Randy Hunt, the defensive coordinator, and Ron Miles, the secondary coach, with Scott Kalua coaching the safeties. They're doing just enough to confusing their throwing the ball downfield. I still believe they've got to go outside with him. There's Scott Kalua, the safety coach, former NFL player, played football here. A lot of Huskies around this town.
Third and 14. BYU goes empty in the backfield. And the Huskies start licking their chops. There's no way you can leave Sarkisian unprotected in that backfield against this rush, baby.
If I may be mistaken, they might have only had 10 guys on the field. He turned around to look for a running back, and he wasn't there. And there was a wing and a flag on the square, and that only counts 10 guys. Fialaga 54, then there's Jason Jordan coming around the outside. Fiala number 57 up inside. But I'm pretty sure there's only 10 guys on the field.
Tough enough. Just trying to hold these guys off with 10. No, Boardman under
good
pressure
run.
Gets it off, and he booms a dandy. Back to the 12-yard line, and Payton slammed out of bounds at the 22-yard line. So you can see the number of hurries along with the five sacks. Constant pressure from the Washington defense on BYU today.
And there were a number of voids, you know, I don't know what category you put them on, but they definitely broke his rhythm. Washington sack yards. 5 times 32 yards.
This will be the final play of the third quarter. And it'll be Dillon, the JC transfer, who will run down the final few seconds. And Washington will take a 27-10 lead over BYU into the final 15. We'll be back with that between BYU and Washington after this message and word from our ABC station.
Three obvious differences in these two football teams. Number one, ability to run the football right here. Number two, pass coverage. Number three, pass rush. And that's what the Huskies have done today.
Second and four to start the final quarter, 27-10. A lot of action and more as Dillon breaks free. 45 inside the 40-yard line.
Well, good offensive blocking that time on the strong side. They came off the ball and just nailed him. Just man-to-man blocking, coming off the ball with big people on big people. He found that crack. That's Mustafa Sabi, number 78, got a nice block at the point. Just see, and then gets in the field, and he makes people miss. Nothing like north-south running.
a 33-yard run. Comes right back with Dillon. And we have had a lot of sights and sounds. Let's take you back to the highlights of this one. The Huskies leading it 27-10. And Fortney handing off to Dillon, who's been impressive here in the early moments of the fourth quarter. With Jack Aroon and Dick Vermeil, I'm Brent Musburger. Dick, are you surprised by anything we've seen here so far?
No, I really am surprised at the fact that BYU hasn't been more effective throwing the football. I'm surprised that they've had as many pass protection problems, because we saw them against Texas A&M, and we really respected Texas A&M's pass rush. I think the difference has been the secondary coverage by the Huskies has been very tight and very good and very consistent, and therefore they've really shut down the passing attack, and they've only given up a few yards running.
Third and short, that's Cleland. He'll lead the blocking. First down, and there's a penalty flag. This will bring it on back.
Holding on the offense, 10-yard penalty, repeat third down.
The big offensive line coming off the ball. I think they're wearing down those defensive people up front for the Cougars. You know, Benji Olsen at over 300 and Olin Krutz at 300 and Bob Sapp at 300, and they're good athletes coming up off the ball like that. They're wearing them down. They're knocking them back.
Lynn Johnson has returned to that left tackle spot. I know that he was out for a time, or he's number 57. He was out for a time in the first half. Sapp is right next to him, 72. Third and nine. Three-man rush.
Blitz.
Throw the blitz package off of it. Sheehy.
You better be able to tackle. You better be able to tackle that guy, because he doesn't give you anything directly to hit, and when he gives it to you, he takes it away from you.
Jack, what about Mr. Sapp?
Well, Brent, you said 6'5", 300 pounds. He is really the main cog inside the interior lineman, but he's also one of the team leaders. He wants to be a wrestler, a professional wrestler. And one of the writers here in town asked him, well, what name would you go by? He says, oh, I don't know, with the way I look, how about the human Sharpay? What do you think? Back and forth? I don't know.
He's already got his degree in sociology. I don't know what he wants to wrestle for.
Fourth down. Fortney straight back. They're going to go for the score. Incomplete. BYU ball at the 31-yard line. They'll take over. Ben Cook with coverage in the end zone, and it was good. Somewhat surprising that Fortney didn't roll and try to run for the first. In Seattle with 11:50 to go. The Cougars with the football coming out from their own 32-yard line, trail at 27-10. And they stretch Mealy out wide. Lewis, the tight end to the right. They put it into Mealy's hands. Mealy rumbles to the 44-yard line, and Mel Miller has returned after that hit he took on that collision with Tony Parrish. So both Miller and Parrish return to play.
You know what's impressive about this play? That Mel Miller has been out of the ball game. He was involved in that collision, as you just said, Brent. But look at him come up and make a collision of his own. That did not affect him. He's a tough guy.
These two freshman quarterbacks have really held up here today. The Huskies first down. Sarkisian and the Cougars need three scores to pull it out. And here is Kalalui. He's free, 40-yard line. down to the 37-yard line. Another first down with Burton making the stop.
You know, and even that though he throws a completed pass, they're making Sarkisian pay the price. He got knocked on his tail. They didn't get the stunts picked up inside. The tackle came all the way around the outside and knocked him down. Now you got tight man-to-man bump coverage right here. He comes outside like that, and then he runs off that shoulder, gets a block there, and up the field he goes.
Sarkisian, penalty flag is thrown. He's brought down at the 40-yard line, but the penalty flag is thrown. That was Josh Smith making the stop, and Chorik indicating that there was holding again.
Bell Edwards says, I can't believe it. He is not pleased.
Making it first and 23, eh?
As you coach with a school with a religious denomination, I wonder what you're allowed to say on a sideline as a coach.
Sarkisian fires on a slant, juggle. Mealy's got it. Had he been able to get the handle and hold it cleanly, who knows? Down at the 27-yard line, short of the first down, I believe.
So far as Mealy goes, the offense goes. He's a big guy, and you can't get up and play him tight man to coverage with a little 5'11", 185-pound corner. Here's a tough guy to the right side of your screen. They're just going to tease on him, and they throw it right. He got by him quickly in the hole. Fortunate to hang on to the ball.
Now they come up second and one. Sarkisian snaps it off, puts it into Lewis's hands. And Lewis hit it at 26. If they spot it up there, that's a first down BYU, and that's what they will do.
Coming right at you down the bottom of the screen. It's a little quick slant to the sideline with a slant outside receiver back inside. He reads it. He's just trying to make the first down. Here he's hanging on for his life.
10:22 for BYU to rally. They need to strike quickly here. Sarkisian backside pressure, slips away from it to the left, and now he's got daylight. Keep it out of bounds at the 23-yard line.
Man, I haven't seen a defensive player in a long time dominate a game like Chorik has. He has dominated this football game. He's an avid weight trainer. He's in great condition. He can play as hard in the fourth quarter as he does in the first quarter. 1,000 yards already this year. Nice job, young man. He's going to be numbers today. He's going to be 87% complete, but still a good percentage complete. Just not getting enough help from a protection standpoint. Plus, he's getting knocked down too many times, even when he throws a completed pass.
Second and seven. Again pressure, and again he is wrapped up, this time by Tuiaia.
Hey, good call, but Tuiaia. Even the PA guy can say it better than I can. See, he's quarterback is forced by Chorik to move back up inside. He steps up inside. Now there's good tackle pressure, and here comes old big nut 78 Mac.
That is the sixth sack of the game by the Husky defense. Third down and 13. The ball at the 30, and again he's going. There's number seven. Down at the 41 with a penalty flag.
When that happens, that's a mental mistake in the protection. They just turn Richie loose inside. Pass protections move strong side, weak side, left or right.
Face mask against the Huskies.
What a gift. They just turned Big Richie inside. See, that's a backup guard in there right now. Greg Hogel in 78. Now, I don't know if he made the mistake, but he was on David Richie.
Well, you got to throw in that situation. Dye cramping up a bit, receiving some treatment over here on the BYU sideline right now. 9:15 to go.
Face mask, 5 yards from the previous spot. Third down.
But it will be third and eight. The ball is just inside the 25-yard line. BYU needs to reach the 16-yard line. two down territory here, trailing it by 17. 9-10 left in your football game. Sarkisian under enormous pressure. The BYU offensive line unable to hold up. Again, down he goes in a heap. Tuiaia doing it again.
Yeah, David Ritchie, the other tackle, 97, was involved at both off defensive tackles, rushing the passer much better this week than they did a week ago. Really constant inside pressure. And those are pretty good offensive linemen in there. Good. They force him to step up inside. There's no pocket. No pocket. It collapsed on him by just good, intense rush inside.
The clock is down to 8:26. It is fourth down. They need 11 yards. Penalty flag. And the play is stopped. Before it started, there was a whistle, and the officials step in now.
They better change the pregame meal.
Dead ball, the way of the game, against the offense, 5 yards.
BYU 14 penalties. They averaged just under 7 penalties a game last year. Doubled it right here.
Now they need 16 yards. Protection's good. Got a man. First and goal, BYU at the 4 yard line.
They went zone. And you could have. You could bet up here that they're going to get the ball to Mealy. Here he is in the middle of the slot right there at the 30. Going to come down. See, they turn him loose inside there into the zone, expecting a safety to come over and get there. And he got there just a little late. Majel Burton gets there just a second late. Still under pressure, but a better job of pass protecting than they've been doing.
Mealy with 8 catches for 107 yards. Now the Cougars with a first and goal from the 4 yard line. Latue is in behind Johnson. That's Lewis, who slips and now goes back. They'll run Latue short. Close to the 1 yard line. Now it'll be second and goal. The time remaining in this game, 7-12. 27-10, a 17-point Husky lead.
That time, Sarkisian. He didn't like the way the wing back started in motion. He's up there over the center of the goal line. He tells him to go back the other way. I don't want you here.
And Ronnie Jenkins is stood up. It is third and goal as the Huskies continue to take time off the clock.
You know, I saw the Huskies defense play a number of times last year in person. And I saw them play on game tape, and this defense is playing better than I saw last year's defense play.
Aliaga is in there along with Jensen. It's Aliaga who really made the big stick on that. Now it is third and goal.
You got to really be alert now for good play action pass.
It is Sarkisian on the fake, throws. Touchdown BYU. Mealy, who's had a big day receiving, comes up with the throw. And the Cougars are still alive in Seattle.
He's such a factor. You just got, if you have skilled people, one of the keys offensively are to get the ball in his hands as many ways as you possibly can. Here's Coach Al Roberts was talking there.
Now, not only do they need this extra point, but now is the time to start thinking about an onside kick. This pulls them to within 10. Oh, that missed field goal earlier in the day, huh? Hutchman here to kick it off, and indications are that they're going to take it back deep. hangs it high. Jarzynka lets Dillon come on over. 15. They try to cut him off, and they do. A beautiful stop there at the 18-yard line. And that hit was made by number 23, Greg White.
This action right here, they start the backs in one direction, hold a tight end, and a good fake right there. Bring him across the formation. Finds that little hole in there. Touchdown. Well done.
It is simply up to the BYU defense to hold on after Mealy makes that diving grab in the end zone. It's a 10-point lead for Washington. BYU must get the ball back in a hurry.
Look for the quarterback to keep the ball in this series sometimes, coming out that backside.
Washington will be looking for first downs. Fortney will flare the ball out. Dillon can run all day. Crosses the 35-yard line to the 37. It'll be first down, Washington.
See, against the split end flanker slot defense, they go to a three deep coverage, and you throw that out there to that wide back swinging out there. The wide receiver goes and pushes the corner off. A linebacker has to get there to make the play. It's a very soft corner.
Now let's see if Fortney brings the clock down. 10 seconds left. There's that. Takes the snap at 6. And they cross the 40-yard line. The Cougars with 2 timeouts remaining. The Huskies with all 3 of theirs. 5:42 to go, and a ball control drive right now would just about do it.
And I really think from a defensive standpoint, you've got to go ahead and take some chances that you normally don't like to take. You've got to make an attempt to get in there, shake the ball loose, and you're not going to do it with down 4. You've got to include some linebackers or even a strong safety or free safety blitz.
So again, Fortney now taking time.
They're going to throw it.
Bringing it down inside of 10 seconds with that formation. Fortney on a quick draw. Fires it out to Dillon, who slipped short of the first down. But this will leave them with about a 3rd and 1.
So far in that one back set, every time the running back has been offset and not behind the quarterback, they've thrown the ball.
I'm not the coach, but Dick, I'm surprised that the way this game has gone, that BYU did not try an onside kick back there and gamble.
I think it was worth a shot. Plus, when they didn't line up for an onside, I thought they might try to pooch it over that front group. There's a big area in that return area.
First down to the 42-yard line with 4:27 remaining.
Both of these running backs, Rashawn Sheehy, Corey Dillon, doing a good job of finding daylight when the main point of attack is not there. He'll follow his fullback up in there. Reed gets a block, and he just sort of slips and slides through there. Not good tackling coming inside out by Brad Martin. They didn't tackle well last week either. They didn't tackle real well against A&M. Sometimes that's a sign of not being quite as quick as you'd like to be defensively.
Corey Dillon behind Sheehy, and the Huskies have some depth at that running back spot. And again, Fortney's hard count. No penalty. Yes, here's the penalty flag thrown now as Dillon is wrapped up. The linesman over here on the near side finally threw it. First down. And it's a 1st and 5 situation after the 5-yard penalty for offside. Down, big holes, crosses the 30 to the 28-yard line. Now 3:30.
I'll tell you this.
So Michigan upsets Colorado 20-13.
Big win. I'll tell you, that time Benji Olsen, the offensive right guard, came off the line of scrimmage and blocked about as well as you can block. Here he is right here coming off right there on number 91, Henry Bloomfield. Now watch this block, ladies and gentlemen. That is an intimidating block. Can't do it any better.
3:10. 10-point lead. Dillon again. Looking good.
I'll tell you, the down 4 playing right now for BYU, they're sucking a little bit. They're They're out of gas. They've been pounded on and beat on and they can't hold up. And they're just getting knocked off the line of scrimmage. I guess when you get hit for four quarters by 300 pounders, you do get a little bit tired.
We may be back in Seattle before this year is over, my good friend.
Yes, I think so. When they get Tony Coates back at that left tackle position, the weak side tackle, that's going to help him too. He's the player that didn't play today.
And remember, the Huskies had an amazing comeback down in the desert last week and came up short. Lost on field goal with 2 seconds remaining in that game. They were down 42-21 with 12 minutes to go against Arizona State. That's when Brock Huard led that comeback. But it was not to be. Arizona State kicked the field goal. Well, the Big Ten starting to shape up with Notre Dame in the Midwest. They hammered Purdue, so certainly it's Penn State, Michigan, Ohio State jumping back to the top of that. A minute 50 to go. And the Huskies with a third and one. Slam down at the 35-yard line. Into Pooch this baby right here now for the Huskies. Hangs it high. Got a chance.
Yeah, beautiful.
There it is. How about that, huh?
Well done.
Well, there he is, and 11-0. After a loss during the regular season. That's the record, so just try to beat these Huskies twice in a row. Yeah. The crowd alive in Seattle. They'd like to see a little safety. Washington has dominated this game.
There it is.
There it is. Jensen. 121 to go. A safety.
I tell you, the defensive line coach has to be really pleased with these guys because they have really done a good job. Randy Hart, the defensive coordinator, coaches the defensive line. They are much better this week than they were against Arizona State a week ago.
And that might have been Sarkisian's fault that time.
Oh, yeah, he should have run over the ball.
He
should have thrown the ball away. I'll tell you, he's courageous. He's going to stand in there. See, he has good protection up in the middle. Now he's pushed, and he can't see.
Oh, you know, the 46. There he is.
Oh, my gosh.
That's his third sack. There have been 8 sacks overall. Allen's got to run it down.
Oh, better get on.
Bobbles it at the 15-yard line and gets back down now. And here are our Chevrolet most valuable players of this game. Mealy, the big tight end of BYU, had a productive day. And Chorik has just been outstanding on that defensive line. There's been any unit that has dominated, it has been Jason Chorik and his buddies in that defensive line. Sarkisian could never settle into a rhythm. 8 sacks, 3 of them by that man right there. One of the great defensive performances that we have ever seen.
Really, it's one of the best I've ever seen.
Unbelievable. Just,
he is. You know, when you combine talent with an attitude to compete like he possesses, you've got a real gem.
Well, the final minute 13, I'm sure that this is very discouraging, disappointing for BYU and the WAC, but still time, and there'll be some Donnybrooks unfolding in that conference this year with their championship game on December 7th in Las Vegas. That's where the WAC will determine its champion in the expanded league. We've got a timeout here.
In the long run, this may be good for BYU. I mean, and maybe that's a rationalization statement type thing, but it's an eye opener, a wake up call. You know, you can't come into the Pac-10 and play poorly and win. And it'll, I think, get them going entering into that WAC conference now, and they'll get their motors running again.
So there's young Huard. Guru told you he was speared a little bit with that series that he commanded in the first half. Was intercepted in the end zone. I think it was Walker who picked it off, if I recall right, for BYU. 29-17. The Huskies were favored, around a 4-point.
That's what's confusing about the Huskies there. You see the two guys hug? both wearing number 78.
Listen.
And they both start. One on offense and one on defense.
This is the school of the duplicate numbers. I love everything in this city except duplicate numbers, okay?
Especially on starting units.
Love the people, the food, the whole thing.
Two number one, play one offense and one defense, 278s, one tackle, one offensive tackle, one defensive tackle. Whew. I can smell the smoke burning up here. I know that. It's a good football team. Well, Jim Lambright said that they're, you know, they don't have a lot of guys on scholarship right now, but the guys they have, he has some good football players, and if they can, the young guys can gain experience, and as good guys play up to their ability, they're going to be a fine football team.
His defensive backs, those two freshmen, were on a mission.
Dandies. They're dandies. They were on a mission, as you said. It wasn't the Fiji Islands either.
I'm telling you. Yearbrook coming in.
Yeah, he's frustrated.
And yeah, sure. Last 15 seconds, and that's going to do it now. Seconds will tick away. Two good friends here. Lambright and Edwards are very good friends. They both have a lot of respect for each other. And Lavelle now walks across.
Washington 29.
29-17.